All right, I call this meeting to order at 7:15. This is a policy committee of the Isla Vista Community Services District. Roll call, Ethan Bertrand.
Present.
Spencer Brandt.
Present.
Jay Freeman. Present. We begin with approval of the minutes. I did action minutes.
Looks good.
Yes.
I think it looks really good.
And in the process of reviewing the minutes, I will thereby apologize for the following mistakes that are not in the minutes. They are mistakes related to the minutes. There is a mistake in the minutes. It should say next meeting is Monday, April 10th at 5 p.m., not at 6 p.m. I went back and double checked that. We had decided to do 5.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which is the first apology that I have, is that I sent out a meeting cancellation for a meeting that was at 6 that we never had in the first place.
That's okay. You are forgiven.
Okay.
Is that the only correction?
That is the only correction I have.
Did you have a time for when we adjourned by any chance?
I do have a time for when you adjourned.
Okay, so.
The time was 8.02 p.m.
So then perhaps if we insert that.
Okay.
Are those the only things?
That's all that I've seen. Thank you.
I move the approval of the minutes with the correction of the next meeting to April 10th at 5 p.m. and to include the time of adjournment of 8.02 p.m.
I'll second that.
Public comment? Okay. The other thing is you will note that we had future agenda items, which we had talked about at the previous meeting, none of which appear on today's agenda. That is totally my fault.
Cool.
I'm pretty certain that it's looking at these things, that's probably okay.
Yeah.
But what was I going to say? All right, so vote. Roll call, I guess. I don't know what we're doing. No, we're not doing that anymore. Now we've been doing a lot of other votes.
Whatever you
call
it.
What do we call the other votes? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Hearing no noes, that motion passes 3-0.
It'd be called a voice vote. Or at least that's how I referred to it.
Okay.
When
in fact, I forgot. This is the same mistake I made last time. Is I forgot that I need already be starting to taking notes because this is already a motion. So you moved something.
I moved the approval of the minutes with corrections.
I will actually. This one will be easy to find. So I just remember it down. That it's in the first 2 minutes of the meeting. Okay. And that was Spencer that moved it, and Ethan seconded it. Okay, public comment period. At this time, members of the public may speak on any matter under / within the subject jurisdiction of the policy committee. I added the / from the previous agenda time. Jonathan, do you have anything you want? Nothing really?
Nothing.
Oh,
nothing right now.
Okay.
Yeah, if I have ideas or comments, I'll say
them. All right, so moving on to our actual agenda, consider striking the word slanderous from the decorum policy. At the full board meeting, Natalie wanted to strike the word slanderous as used in the decorum policy. This requires further sentence edits for policy recommendation. Now we will stare at that and decide if we want to do that. And I was supposed to bring up the... No, it's not there.
Are you looking for the definition of slander? Because I've got it pulled up.
That's not what I was going to pull up. Okay. But that also sounds really awesome.
Yeah.
What do you got there?
Would you like me to state it?
Yeah.
So the definition of slander as defined by law.com... which I'm not sure what the source is, but the definition is oral defamation in which someone tells one or more persons an untruth about another, which untruth will harm the reputation of the person defamed.
Could you say that again?
Oral defamation in which someone tells one or more persons an untruth about another, which untruth will harm the reputation of the person defamed. So I think the key thing here is that the untruth will harm the reputation. I'll just say I appreciate the fact that Natalie was interested in this in this specific line. I can only guess as to like what exactly her intentions were, and I don't want to assume what exactly, because I don't think she really stated very much in the meeting other than something that she wanted us to look at.
also was very, like, she didn't have much time to come up with that. So
yeah,
kinda
we kind of, it was kind of on the fly. Yeah. But I would say that I imagine the concern is that it would be used overly, there would be too much, that it would be used by the chair in a manner that would suppress the opinions of the public, members of the public who wish to speak. I personally think that the definition of slander as stated that we have before us is something that is, I think that it creates a standard that is high enough to where I don't share that concern. There's a reason that I voted for this policy. It's because I stand behind it. And I voted for it here in the committee and at the board level. And that's kind of what I think about that. What do you all think?
I agree. And I see that. So slanderous, that's in our example CSD handbook, which is definitely one of the places that we got it from to put in there. I'm looking to see if it's also in the Vandenberg Village CSD one. I didn't see it in the IBRPD one. Right now I'm just trying to figure out where exactly we got it.
No slanderous in VBCSD.
Okay.
Oh, wait a second, but you only gave me a fragment of it, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
You have the full VVCSD.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and what's the title of the document?
VVCSD-PM of B.
Oh, but if
I
you...
Just have,
oh,
oh,
you don't have any...
I just have
oh,
the...
Code of Ordinances. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So a comment that I will make on this is that we did, however, make some modification to some wording that we had obtained because we didn't like the fact that it was essentially trying to protect the wrong people. I think there was a modification that we made.
Yes.
Slanderous is defined that has, which is from a legal perspective I like, which is that it has to be an untrue statement. But I'm wondering how useful that context is in the course of a board meeting. I mean, is the chair going to make a claim about the truth of the thing that the person is saying without pulling out references and trying to get into an argument about that? So I'm not actually certain if it is even if it even gives the board any teeth and then is liable to be used in an incorrect manner at some point in the future.
I think the spirit of the policy is something that we also have to consider. It's basically a policy that, at least from my perspective, its intention is to keep order at the board meeting and prevent these kind of shouting matches from happening, which is certainly what I would hope that this would be able to do. I don't think any of our intentions that we would, you know, if someone declared that there's a slanderous statement being made that we stop the meeting and, like, adjudicate that internally. It's something I think that people understand the meaning of slanderous and they understand, people would be able to tell you what it sounded like, specifically because it would be causing harm to reputation. I mean, any other word that we replaced that with, if we replaced it with, instead of slanderous, we said personal attacks, which I think that actually, hold on, let me find this policy. We don't have personal attacks in there. I think that's actually what we took out.
Yes.
I think slanderous, I think the same thing that I thought when we first approved this, was just slanderous is a better standard than personal.
Yeah, and I've looked in the Code of Ordinances, nothing's coming up from slander. So I think the only example we had was
Can you read from the CSDA sample manual?
Yes, absolutely. The president shall take whatever actions are necessary and appropriate to preserve order and decorum during board meetings, including public hearings. The president may eject any person or persons making personal, impertinent, or slanderous remarks, refusing to abide by a request from the president, or otherwise disrupting the meeting or hearing. So with that, we took out the personal part, which I think that was a great decision on all of our behalfs.
Yeah.
I was comfortable with what we arrived at here.
Yeah.
I'm also comfortable that we arrived at here from the legal definition of slanderous, but then I started thinking about it from the perspective of, like, well, how might it accidentally get used and what kind of argument might end up occurring.
I think if there's any word that we should be concerned about, it's impertinent, which I'm not even, like...
What's the definition of impertinent?
Not showing proper respect or rude.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, I always thought a bit more as off-topic.
You know, that was actually the mistake that I made as well.
Oh, that's,
yeah.
Oh, so it shows the formal version of it is not pertinent to a particular matter, irrelevant. So I guess two definitions.
Yeah.
Okay. Which I think is the definition it's referring to.
One's kind of more the colloquial version of it. Yeah. I mean, the ability for the president to be able to eject someone who is causing the meeting to come to a halt and doing something that is causing, harm to the experience of the rest of the audience at the meeting is something that I really want to preserve. I think slanderous is a much better standard than personal, or even impertinent for that matter. So, I mean, on one hand, we could recommend that we strike the word impertinent, and we could give the explanation to Natalie back at the meeting. It's not exactly what she wanted.
I would imagine, but slanderous.
On the other hand, we could stand behind our policy because we did recommend the policy. Every director voted to approve that policy, from what I can recall, and I think that it's a good policy.
I added the other definition of impertinent, I don't like the first definition you read of impertinent.
But I don't think that's its intention in here. I think
it's not the formal definition. Yeah.
But again, we need to write something that somebody else isn't going to be like, well, it says impertinent, and the definition of impertinent. If you meant the other thing, you should have said the other thing.
But I think it's clear, though.
We also have to keep in mind the context, which is that, like, if we have a board president who is ejecting people mm-hmm. for making what they define as rude remarks and it's using a very abstract definition of the word rude, then that person is not going to have support from the greater community. I just don't see a situation where that would practically happen and that we would need to adjudicate something based on the policy. I think that in this the case of a slanderous kind of thing, then it's a little bit different. That is a higher standard and one that could be, I don't want to say debated, but I mean it's something where there could be, that's a more relevant situation in my mind rather than someone making like using an overly broad definition of the word impertinent and like trying to take someone out for saying something rude.
And no matter what, following the open meeting laws, we do need to respect people's rights to participate in our meeting. So ultimately, this is a great guide for how we are to maintain decorum, but what we're ultimately responsible for is making sure that we don't violate the Brown Act by not allowing a member of the public to participate in an open meeting. So I think that even though a board president down the line could be super kind of angled with their interpretation of this, ultimately, as with everything in this policy manual, they do need to follow the law and allow members of the public to participate.
But then we shouldn't be writing policies that we anticipate are going to be in conflict with the law.
I don't think it's in conflict with the law.
So the scenarios that I keep thinking of related to this are the ones at the Board of Supervisors where there's one person who's just been coming for the last few months in order to argue about his property.
Yeah. Carpinteria.
And I actually don't know where it is. I just know it's a property issue.
I actually know his name. There so many times.
And the extent to which there are arguments then about whether or not that person should be allowed to continue speaking. And then the other one being John, I think is his name, Dr. John.
Dr. Johns.
Mm-hmm. And I always end up feeling sometimes like the attempts to stop him from speaking during the time period that he has been given look a lot worse to me than just allowing him to say what he wants to say during his 3 minutes and then sit down. Having the slanderous one, I'm okay with, because I've dealt with mm-hmm. contracts before that are slanderous, and so I just immediately think of the legal version of it. But I think you have a different definition for impertinent. When I saw impertinent, I assumed it meant things that are off agenda that we don't have to allow them to speak about.
Yeah.
But I'm concerned about putting something in here that allows us to essentially tone police somebody who is coming to us with some kind of issue. And today, it's we've got board members that we like, but it's always like a situation where in the future, maybe the one person who you think is the least forgiving about public comment is the person who is the chair for whatever reason. A lot of our boards in the area have chair rotation.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if you wanted to substitute impertinent for another word, do you have any ideas?
The first thought I have, and maybe this is not maybe this is now too general, but it's off topic.
That's what I came up with right now, and then I thought that just seems too much. That just seems too informal.
Okay.
So then I came to irrelevant, but that just has its own kind of more informal connotation that I don't think would be solving the problem that we have.
Making slanderous remarks or dwelling on topics outside of our jurisdiction.
Or not germane.
Say that again.
Not germane. That's like the word the Senate uses.
That's a word, though. That's two words, right?
Yeah.
Okay. We have to restructure the sentence more in order to fit that in, because you can't just say making not germane or slanderous. Yeah.
But I mean, as far as irrelevant, like I feel like that's another word that's extremely subjective.
Loaded. Yeah.
Yeah. Which I think kind of the intent of this is, unfortunately.
Yeah, I think not germane actually is a good standard. The definition is closely or significantly related. The example given is, please keep your statements germane to the issue.
Okay, do you have a way of restructuring the sentence to allow us to use the word germane?
let me find what this is. The president may eject any person or persons making slanderous remarks or statements that are not germane to items under the subject jurisdiction matter of the board of directors.
Subject jurisdiction, you said matters, but I think just subject jurisdiction
of the board of directors.
Well, should it be specific to an agenda item, though?
Yeah.
Because if
this is the standard for ejecting people from the meetings, though.
At some point,
also, germane is,
I'm
sure you can see.
Don't worry about it. Right, but let's say like we're in discussing the approval of policies,
it's
and all of a sudden
right.
Someone's talking about
M-A-N-E.
Public engagement. I feel like that's under the subject jurisdiction of the board of directors. The chair can't stop them if it was to just be that. But I mean, I don't know. That's just my initial take on it.
I think this is fine. I mean.
Or wait, it says germane to items under the subject. I guess if it has that items.
I think this is good. I think this is better than what we had.
Rather than board of directors, should it be district? Subject jurisdiction
like
of
district
the district.
Better. Spencer?
Yes.
Yeah,
I think this is good.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's not what Director Jordan asked us to do, but I think that it is certainly addressing a relevant issue. And the only thing is that I'm worried about under this item if we're allowed to recommend it.
Yeah, I think this might need to wait until item 4.
Okay.
Let's table it.
Press save
and move on.
Oh, Jonathan, anything you want to say about anything else before we move on?
No.
All right. Number 2, discuss structure surrounding agreements and contracts. In quotes, because that's how it's forwarded. On last week's agenda, Jay pointed out agreements with the university were likely to always be negotiated with George. But George had started to recuse himself from related discussion during committee meetings, and now during any tangential discussion during the full board meeting, along with the Brown Act. In some cases, an agreement might even be drafted by George. In such a case, it is impossible to get any clarification on the meeting or intent of the agreement for any director not involved in the negotiation, which might be all directors. During this item, we will discuss the scope of this problem and try to come up with policy-oriented solutions to any issues.
So before we start, I just want to
say
that I would appreciate in the future if you were to write agenda items in a way that doesn't try to provide this sort of context. I think we've kind of spoken about this before. I understand that there is a want to provide context, but this doesn't summarize, you know, actions that we could possibly be taking. It's very informal. I don't think that it reflects well in the district when we have things like this on our agenda, because they are too much of the he said, she said.
Okay.
It's just, like, frankly, unprofessional. So I would appreciate if you would observe the kind of guidelines that I put in the memo regarding agenda items for board of directors. I think it's a good standard, and that's kind of why I wanted folks to do it.
At the last meeting of policy committee, I thought what we had agreed on was that we were actually going to require people to have background, and that you were going to actually require people to provide a letter that was going to actually go along with things to provide background and even financial analysis. And so I actually felt that something horrible happened at that last meeting. I mean, it was just, I'm going to be bringing this back up, I think, under four, if you allow me to, and if not, because I forgot to put it as I was going to make an entire agenda item about your agenda notes, but I'm going to be trying to bring it under four.
You mean my memo?
Your memo.
Okay.
But, yeah.
Anywho, we can continue on to the bulk of the item, though. The proposal is for...
I don't have a proposal.
Or not the proposal. The item is for us to consider recommendations to the board, or I assume that it is, because I'm not sure if recommendations...
This item was forwarded to us, I believe, by Bob Geis at my protest.
Okay. Is there something in the text of the item that, give us the authority to take action? Because right now it just says discuss. See, this is kind of what I'm getting into. This is kind of like, I don't want us to tie our hands with these items.
I did not want to be the person to put together this agenda. Would you like to take over the position of writing this agenda? I am not good at it. I do not enjoy it. I do not want to do it. I did not even want to be chair because I would end up having to be the person to put together these documents. If you're going to take such issue with me putting together these documents, I would appreciate it if you actually came up with a solution for that that isn't just berating me.
I'm not berating you, Jay. This is the same standard that we have
yes.
for all directors. And I mean, there have been items that I've written that Ethan has said, I don't think we can take action under this. And
yeah.
I said, my bad, I messed up. Like, I'm sorry. Like, this is not meant to be personal. I'm just telling you the reason that I
said. Can we then discuss it?
I think that we
just wanted to discuss
it. We can discuss it. We can certainly discuss it. I don't think we can take action on it.
Ethan.
The last sentence here says, during this item, we will discuss the scope of this problem and try to come up with policy-oriented solutions to any issues. Well, I don't think that the try to come up with is very clear to what we're doing. I think that allows us to develop a recommendation.
Okay, I was really just asking the question. If you think it allows us to come up with
the issue that I have is that I feel like discuss, consider, try to come up with, I feel like these words actually do imply that we have the ability to do things. I have felt now on multiple occasions that we've had agenda items where people have simply kind of essentially picked on the agenda item, particularly this one on the board agenda last time. I felt it was essentially just... Like, despite the fact that it said that we will discuss this letter, we then were told that we couldn't discuss the letter because it somehow was not part of the agenda item. And so I do not know how to write these in a way that will not apparently cause somebody to nitpick this. I would appreciate if we could talk about this, but if you say that we can't, we'll talk about this again later.
No, we can talk about
okay.
it. The item is called Discuss Structures right. Surrounding Agreements and Contracts. I mean, I think...
I imagine, however, okay, so does can I then provide the context again in order to actually, or am I like?
Like verbally, yeah.
Okay. Yes.
You can provide the context,
okay.
all the context you want. I would appreciate that. That's what discussion is
yeah,
for.
But the reason why we decided to actually provide it in writing last time we had policy committee was because discussions at the board were being cut off, which is why I was not actually okay with having to do this all verbally. So the issue was that we have a contract that we've now actually, the agreement maybe is a better term for it, that we have with the university, and I still do not know when it terminates. That agreement exists now, but we're going to have more agreements, and we're still going to have ways of determining things about those agreements. Normally what you would do is you would have the person who negotiated the agreement from our side appear and describe the agreement in a presentation. You would have the person who negotiated the agreement on the other side come and potentially defend the agreement. You would have county council available in order to explain matters related to the agreement. We have none of these things. We have an agreement to the university where the person who wrote it was the university, and apparently no one on our side negotiated it. We have the person who negotiated on the university was in the room at that time, but refused to answer any questions, and in the future apparently will recuse themselves from future discussions, which is okay. And I can actually, because he's also on our board, I can appreciate why he does that, and I think it's correct that he's doing that. But that also now means that
can I ask a question real
yeah.
quick? Just because I'm curious on that last part you mentioned as well. When you say you think it's appropriate that he recuses himself, do you think it's appropriate based on legal requirement or just good practice?
I think it's actually under the current 1080, I think it was, actually the code on conflict of interest, because he's actually the person who's being paid on the university side in order to come up with things like this, particularly because there was a clause in the MOU which stated that the trust that it satisfies the trustees report, which we didn't have any discussion of, and potentially, and there are all sorts of things that are in that trustees report, right? But that's in his, he's like essentially his job in the as assistant vice chancellor of alumni affairs is to satisfy that trustees report, and so now he's negotiating contracts that supposedly satisfy the trustees report with us. I don't think it's appropriate that he is on the board speaking about those issues. But
and can I raise a point,
yeah.
a brief point, just to address that one concern, because that's been something I've been thinking about as mm-hmm. well. I went to the Attorney General's website. They have a fantastic, lengthy document defining conflict of interest, because in the Political Reform Act, while they do get into various different disqualifying factors, it's all just brief one paragraph things.
Mm-hmm.
But in this document, they really break down what the disqualifying factors are, and one of them is obviously if it's a source of income. And with that, it says a public official has an economic interest if any source of income that is either received or promised to the official and totals $500 or more in the 12 months prior to the decision in question. A conflict of interest results whenever either the amount or the source of an official's income is affected by a decision. For example, a decision that foreseeably will materially affect an official's employer would necessitate disqualification even if the amount of income to be received were not affected. So what it's saying is that either or, whether it's the amount of income someone's receiving or the source, in this case an employer. However, what it goes on to say, common exclusions from the definition of income include campaign contributions, government salaries and benefits, certain types of payment from nonprofit organizations, inheritance, etc. The government salaries and benefits part, when I read that, I thought that was pretty clear that this would be, George's scenario would fall under this type of exclusion. And I believe that's also the intention for why an employee of a state agency doesn't have to list their salary on a Form 700. So going forward, I think it would be great to define the plan that Director Thurlow has for participating in discussion. But I think it's good that we do also consider that legally, it seems that he is able to participate. So hopefully that
so his salary as assistant vice chancellor is government?
Yeah.
I will look into this, but regardless of the
sorry,
when he
was
in the meeting, no, it's fine. No, it's. I think it's fully on topic.
Okay.
But the fact that he is, he was in the meeting, he still refused to answer the questions. I mean, so it's a termination clause is incredibly important to a contract. I mean, it's something where it changes the character of all of the other clauses, whether it be a like salary that somebody is receiving, was it until such time or was it forever? It affects on our side, if we have an expenditure, was it until such time or is it forever? It affects a jurisdiction, is it until such time or is it forever? And it's a kind of thing where the person refused to answer. So now normally, again, if the university negotiates with other groups, like with other government agencies, Kirsten Deschler appears, and Kirsten Deschler is the person who is kind of negotiating this governmental contract. And Kirsten will like answer any questions that LAFCO or the Board of Supervisors might have about an issue. Whereas here we had George Thurlow, and then George offered to bring political science, whom I happen to know is not able to answer any of the questions related to the MOU because they are adamant that they didn't draft it. And so at the full board level, the idea was is to try to discuss this with the, possibly with the university, possibly among the board as far as how we will handle with the university at the policy level. The only thing I've been able to come up with so far is that we could essentially state that there will not be a contract without a negotiator who is willing to answer questions. And then that would, but it's awkward to do that. I don't like coming to policy committee and saying, here's a policy that I happen to know is going to apply to one person, is going to force him to do something. But
I mean, not necessarily. I think being the small town nature of what we're dealing with here, there could be many different things that come up where we're bringing something to the board, where a director might be the chief proponent of it and may be in a situation where they need to make sure before they push this that they'll be able to defend it and to present on it. It may be more of a best practice that we come up with than a policy, but...
Jonathan?
I might have some comments separately about the issue, but in terms of the MOU specifically, I just reread it again. And it does say, I didn't remember this part, the program is the first year spring quarter 2017, and the program will continue through the summer months.
Right, and the question at the time was, does that mean that this agreement terminates at the end of the summer months, or does it essentially just state the program can continue? And the answer was, we do not have funding past spring. I then said, but does that mean that the agreement terminates? Because it at least says summer. Does it terminate after summer? And the answer was, I am not a lawyer.
Right.
I will just say that my additional comment was going to be, you could also just ask for like an addendum to that.
I moved in order to, Ethan said, you have a motion. I moved to amend the contract to add one sentence, which stated that it would simply terminate at the beginning of fall quarter 2017, not friendly with Natalie. And everyone else was unhappy.
Well, maybe it wasn't friendly in like the context of approving it, like adding it then, but maybe like a negotiate, like you could ask Ethan as the president to ask George or the university, whoever, can we change this, and then it would be like an item you can vote on later. Like I know that happens, right? Like could be something for this particular issue. Could help.
Not knowing if we could change an agreement in the future, I would not feel comfortable voting on an agreement whose nature I did not understand. And so I again would have done exactly what I did, which was to abstain.
Cool.
Yeah, I know. Thank you for the thoughts, but...
I think you were saying, though, this is still action that could be taken, right?
Yeah
it is still action that could be taken.
That is
a good point, although I...
I understand.
I can just imagine the unhappiness that will happen if I add that to the agenda. Yeah.
If you ask for an amendment to the agreement,
yeah, we can do that at some other point. It's.
I would say one more thing that this is an MOU, so it's like doesn't. I don't think it has as much legal ground as like a contract or anything else. But I think the university does these on purpose to not get legally binded to things. Like I don't think this MOU has like I don't think like anything bad would come out of. I know like you want to figure this out for the future, but like in this particular case, I don't think the district is in a bad spot for agreeing to it.
I'm not unhappy about our state right now. I'm just wanting to make certain that in the future, I'm able to get the information I need when a new contract comes in, and I'm anticipating it only getting worse if George decides that he might have to recuse himself.
Right.
I'm not like.
And I hope I made it clear that in the future it's important that everyone is respectful on those discussions, because unfortunately I don't think that was what went down. And I wouldn't say I'm speaking really at all at you on that. I think that there were many members of the board who could have been more respectful at the time and open to providing information. I guess rather than saying respectful, obviously we always want to be respectful, I think people could have been more cooperative. And I don't think that happened at the time. And going forward, I think that everyone needs to cooperate and make sure that everyone has the understanding they need to make decisions. I'm thinking right now that I know I saw language somewhere within like a board responsibilities policy perhaps with the Isle of Vista Recreation and Park District, that established something where board members are responsible for providing enough information before making a decision.
I think that so what I'm looking at, just for context, is there are a number of board member policies on the California Special Districts Association website. And I'm looking at Jarupa Community Services District. And I'm looking at section 3. It's brief, but there's a clause that says board members will strive to work in cooperation with other public officials unless prohibited from doing so by law or officially recognize confidentiality of their work, and then it cites some government code. So I think that's a start. I think this is something that we can solve through a policy.
Jonathan?
Yeah, so I bring up my board's policies a lot because I know them really well. So we have a policy on contracts that's more general, and it says, you know, we delegate it to the superintendent president, which I know that you guys don't have yet. But then it says, like, you know, all contracts are subject to the following, and gives a few points. But then we have additional, like, administrative policies that go and discuss, like, you know, I'll just read, personal service contracts are also permissible when any one of the following conditions is met, and like you have to meet those. Or it says the district may enter into personal services contracts to achieve cost savings when each of the following conditions are met. So, I mean, those are each and one of, but it lists like the bare minimum things we need to enter into a contract. So, there you go. Or I would open the personal services one because that's one for the union. But it's AP 6370. And then there's 6380, which is with vendors, which maybe might be more analogous to the university, but it's a very small, short one. The personal services one is the one I thought was like maybe most similar to what you're looking for, which is like having requirements, like the amount of savings clearly justifies the size and duration. You know, these are, for us, our reasons we do it, but I'm sure you guys can come up with any, like, bare minimums you want to have.
And so it's interesting, though, these are, like, reasons to have a contract.
Well, it says these conditions. No, it's like we
conditions
can
by which they can enter
this contract if these conditions are met.
Right,
so
but like most of these, I mean, like, so these are mostly like limitations on the kinds of clauses, except for example, the contract is with a firm. But like for example, you could have a clause that states that we will not enter a contract where the salary of somebody is lower than X. But that's different from the process of negotiating the contract will involve having somebody appear or...
See, well, that's the thing. So you can put that as a condition to meet, is to say, you know, for the board to enter into contract, it needs a clear end date. It needs, you know, presentation from the other agency it's contracting with. It needs presentation from whoever negotiated the contract from our end. These are just examples of, like, you can just structure it this way. Like, you can have each of these conditions must be met, or one of these conditions must be better. And there's other ones in there, so you take a look at like the general board policy. This is an administrative procedure. There's a board policy too, and there's a couple other ones. There are some laws that relate to this, but they're more for like construction and stuff, not what you guys might be doing for a while. There's a law to look into, too. It says, I didn't even read this portion of the policy before. It says, If the best interest of the district will be served by contract, lease, requisition, or purchase order through any other public corporation or agency, in accordance with Public Contract Code Section 20652, then the superintendent president is authorized to proceed with the agreement. But that's not important. It's just the Public Contract Code Section 20652 seems to govern, because the university is a public organization, so it might have different regulations in contracting with a private organization.
20652.
Mm-hmm. Public contract.
Yeah.
Code.
So I think this is specific to community college
is
districts.
It?
Yes.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah, I know.
It might be something similar than somewhere else. But
yeah. I mean, it is the public contract code, so there probably
yeah.
is. We'd have to go look into the code tree. Exceptions in this code. And I'm not seeing, oh, community services districts.
You're looking to move on.
Yeah, I'm like looking at your eyes.
Sorry,
I'm like,
yeah,
like
yeah.
You're still reading this, so I won't use
okay.
the.
Sorry.
Yeah, so if you're looking for the public contract code that pertains to community services districts, you'd be looking for section 20680. And that's in the public contracts code. There's actually a lot of good stuff in here, and it's making me think that we need to start working on a policy for that. I mean, because it should be extensive.
Especially since you guys probably are going to be a contract organization.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
There's a section on the year 2000 problem, vendor compliance. Yes!
Oh, that is too funny.
What the heck?
I really hope it was. I really hope it was AB 2000.
Would it be you guys under Part 3, right? Contracting by local agencies?
Wait, hold on.
Three. Now, wait.
Two.
Wait, now, wait.
There it
yeah,
is.
Yeah, here. Put your chair closer, Jonathan. You need to get you.
Yeah.
Only personally.
Yeah,
can't
local
you
agency.
Can't.
I have
sitting
right here.
Yeah, at least what I'm looking at is under Chapter 1. The Local Agency Public Construction Act, so that obviously pertains to a specific type of contract, but there is Community Services District. If you got to scroll down a while, because there's a bunch of, see, this is what I mean, there's a bunch of exceptions. There you go. And then
there we go. I was just guessing, because when I went to 280, I didn't get the, all it had was just, there will be, yeah. Here we go.
Oh, this is pretty good. I just pulled it up.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and I mean, preliminarily, I'll let you all read this, but as I'm reading this, I'm thinking that this is, I'm actually happy that we have this item on here, because I think it, like Jonathan just mentioned, we are going to be a contract-driven organization. And I think that our policy based off of contracts as a whole, not just kind of the things that you brought up, Jay, but mm-hmm. contracts as a whole is something that we need to have a really strong policy on, and it's something that I like, think we should start working on. I'm not one for wordsmithing this one in a committee meeting because that's too much for my brain. And also, I would love to see what some other districts have done. I haven't really been able to find anything from CSDA. I've looked through IVRPD. I would look through Vandenberg's, but I've noticed that theirs has been a little more less extensive. So I would imagine if it's not, if I can't find anything good in IVRPD, then it's probably not in there. Have you found anything?
No, I'm on the CSDA website right now, and nothing's coming up for contract under policies. It's
I tried
probably in
too.
One of these many listed policies.
Exactly, that's what I'm thinking.
But definitely needs.
I looked for agreements. I looked for contracts. I mean, I'm certain that it's in here somewhere. You're right.
But I think what we can do is kind of define the direction we want to go so that in the future we can come back with the necessary policy recommendation material.
Makes sense to me.
So we...
We've got time.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like...
So certainly we want to... I think biggest intention to make sure all directors receive the information that they need from both... from any parties participating in an agreement.
I'd appreciate that.
Yeah. Can we make a recommendation, or not necessarily a recommendation, but...
Recommend to ourselves.
I think we'll just take notes and remember.
Yeah. For future reference, there's something on CSDA, which also I think we need to talk about making sure that all directors have access to that. Do you know if you have gotten your login
yet?
Have
you gotten an email from...
Gonna be honest, I haven't checked.
Okay. That's okay. We'll do a command F of CSDA and email sometime and let us know if you got a login. There's a policy manual that includes... a specific section on, or not, it's just called Financial Procedures Manual, and it's from Vista, where did it go? I lost it, but it shows promise. I'm seeing a bunch of stuff about contracts in here. I don't know where it went at all. Oh well. I have to say some of these policies is a little off topic, but they're pretty amusing. There's a cell phone allowance policy under personnel.
Yeah, well, if you don't provide some of that stuff.
Yeah, I know. I can foresee us having to implement that someday.
I know that from firsthand experience as a manager.
As a manager of people
in the company.
I was going to say, did you have a classroom policy on that? So Ethan, can you read back to us what you have?
Oh, just make sure that all board members have the information from all parties involved that are necessary for making a decision to enter into an agreement.
Scroll. There's something. I pulled it. Sorry.
Oh, you wanted to see this?
Yeah. Oh, that's what it was. Yeah. Do we want to make this recommendation?
I think we're just.
Oh, this is for us.
Taking notes.
Yeah. But what else do we want to get out of the policy? Because, I mean, we obviously need to create a larger agreement and contract.
Oh, these are... Oh, that's what you meant when you said recommendations to us.
Yeah, this isn't a recommendation
to
the board. This is just where do we want to go.
I thought you were making a joke in reference to something else. Never mind.
No joke involved.
Yeah, I know.
what else would we want to get out of a policy about contracts? Procedures for how they are presented to the board, procedures for who negotiates them.
And would MOUs fall under this policy? Would it be a policy for agreements and contracts, or?
I would imagine that there'd be separate standards because there's separate kinds of agreements.
Okay.
But as a,
I've not
as
had
a
chance to look at to watch it yet, but I was told that there was a Board of Supervisors meeting recently where they spent an insane, like a crazy amount of time arguing about whether they should have an MOU or a joint powers agreement because they had a particular liability issue. So.
And what I'm seeing for MOU is a formal agreement between two or more parties. Companies and organizations can use MOUs to establish official partnerships. MOUs are not legally binding, but they carry a degree of seriousness and mutual respect stronger than a gentleman's agreement.
Is there a legal standard for gentleman's agreement?
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, because that's kind of what I was thinking too.
Yeah.
Again, that's amusing. But I don't think that our board will be adopting any gentleman's agreements.
I don't either. I really hope not.
If we're thinking about just
general things that we want to see out
issues,
of this.
Of course, we're going to have to come up with, and this is going to be so horrendous to sit around and to try to figure out, but some kind of mechanism for handling bidding. Because I think we're actually required for certain kinds of contracts also to have a bidding process, and then it's just going to,
yeah.
Part of it is in this code.
For these policies, we really need to look into how far a director is allowed to be involved. Rather than, and I mean, really, the last board meeting was when we started discussing directors versus a general manager or administrator.
Mm-hmm.
We need to look into what that looks like, because I'm pretty sure the board president in other policies of other districts can be involved in things like this, but we just need to consider what type of language we need.
Mm-hmm. Jonathan?
I was just gonna say, in terms of bidding, you don't have, well, at least our district doesn't have to bid if we're doing it with a public agency. We don't have to compete for a bid.
Yeah. I was just saying, if we are talking about general contracts and everything, then we'll have to.
Yeah. We should have it in there for sure.
That's what I was about to bring up, that exact point, which is that we need to identify the specific authority that we have to enter into agreements, like with circumventing that normal bidding process, since I imagine that given that we have the university, we have the county, we have all these other agencies that we might contract with, that we're going to be, that'll be an important piece of policy for us to have.
Especially the policing power, like it just even says you can enter a contract with the county or university.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a clear one.
It's kind of a blessing.
We can't enter into a contract with like some armed vigilantes. The authors of AB3 had foresight.
I think these are all good directives for us to keep in mind going forward.
I agree. It's certainly on my to-do list to go and look into other, the way that other agencies handle this in their policy manual. I think that it might even be good for us to err on the side of length when it comes to this policy. Because just as I was kind of saying, I didn't really see a whole lot about it in IVRP's policy manual. But that's okay if our policy ends up being a lot more lengthy and extensive. We might not find a whole lot of other examples of something that is like adequate for us. Is there anything else? Do we need to like take a vote on this, or is, I mean, I think we we all kind of mutually agree.
I don't think we should record it, vote on anything that we're forwarding to ourselves.
Yeah.
And,
should we just record it in the minutes that these are the things that we wanted to keep in mind going forward with?
Okay. Are you satisfied with the way that I've written it?
Yeah.
Jonathan.
This is not about that, but I've just Googled Community Services District contract policy. Community Center Community Services District has a policy that seems to have some, like, a good amount of the things you guys.
Which district?
Trinity Center.
Trinity Center.
So, like, defines the types of agreements, authority, you know, makes clear who has the authority, terms and conditions, like, prior to entering into any agreement, the scope, cost of terms and conditions must be fully understood. Scope must be finite and clearly documented, like stuff like that. So,
this is their policy manual.
Yeah, when you click, when you Google it, it's the first thing that came up for me. It'll say policy manual, but you only get this policy.
Oh yeah, looks good.
Oh, it even says there's one clause under it called project management. It says all contracts agreement entered into by the board where significant scope and or costs are involved will have a project manager assigned. The project manager may be a director or an employee of the district. So that's another thing that was just talked about too.
Oh yeah, and we have things about the competitive bidding process.
Yeah, so maybe I guess our homework is to read through all of this. And
yeah, that's right.
You can even assign someone.
Thank
to
you so much, Jonathan.
That's
really
a good one. Thanks.
Yeah. Okay, so are we finished with this one, taking no action? Any last comments, Jonathan?
Oh, I have comments on how to phrase it. Maybe who negotiates them, maybe just have procedures after bidding. Without the comma?
Yeah, no comma necessary.
Oh, bidding procedures, okay.
Yeah. And then what's
so
the last one?
Bidding and procedures.
Maybe directors.
Originally, I wasn't going to include that on the list. Okay. Role of directors.
Sure.
Sweet.
Or maybe extent of director's role. Because there, I feel like that implies, like, how far can a director go?
Allowed extent of director's role?
Sure.
So that's going to be searching through code.
That's pretty well fleshed out in this policy.
Yeah.
We'll see it.
I wonder if they were at one time in a similar situation as we.
Yeah, I like that.
Okay.
Cool. That's great.
Agenda item 3. Compile and recommend a district donation policy. As a recommendation from Formation Committee forwarded through the full board, we have been directed to compile and recommend a district donation policy. We will look over what was provided by Bob, attachment A, in your handout is attachment B, and come with the policies for how the district will take donations. Oh yeah, I held up another sheet of paper, it's attached to the,
So I tried my best to kind of summarize, or not summarize, to delineate what Bob had sent us and make it into like a more policy format, and I also made some edits and like looked at other donation policies. I looked at the, both of them were from the California Special Districts Association samples.
Oh, cool. Which one were you looking at?
Donation policies?
Yeah.
There were two of them. One of them was like a Word document.
Yes. Was it
the
a city?
One. Yeah, they're both cities. One of them was just called like city donation policy. The other one was like a specific city name. But I have it on a Google Doc if you want to take a peek at it. Like if you want... I can either share it with you or it's from my CSD account, so I can share it to your CSD account if you'd like.
That works for me.
Sorg.ivcsd
plus
ivcsd, even better. At sorg.com.
Yeah.
All right. So it says that there's no Google account associated with
it. There isn't a Google account. It's
okay.
Not a Google account.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense, actually. But you'll still be able to open it. It'll still send it to you.
Okay, good.
Oh, well, I was asking. I hope so.
It looks like the answer will be yes.
Okay, cool.
I'm just gonna end up requesting. I had to request access as my Google, as this Google account.
Okay.
Now you've received
whatever works for you to make sure that things don't get messy with your different accounts.
It's just I don't want to proliferate multiple Google accounts.
Uh-huh.
I don't even like having one Google account. So now you've received another email.
Yeah.
I think you have to accept.
Okay, we'll check. Yeah, both of the city policies listed on the CSDA list are, I'd say, a little bit more straightforward than the policies recommended to the board initially. Would you concur? Straightforward than the policies that Bob showed us? Yes, I do agree with that. And after looking through both of them and looking through what Bob showed us, I actually favor what Bob showed us because it establishes some like very specific procedures, and so I found it more helpful to see it that way.
Yeah.
I think there are a couple things that didn't quite make it in here, and we can hash that out. That are things that were on Bob's. But the general overview is that there is this sort of introductory statement. There is basically the definition of what a donation is, who can donate, what kind of entities can donate, and specifications on thresholds for donating. Then there are procedures. There are, I believe, six different classifications. The two divisions being between cash donations and non-cash donations, the same as is with Bob. Just about all the procedures that are in the county procedures for, say, C1.
Where are those six?
Yeah, like I said, I don't think that I quite finished that part right there,
yeah.
So my bad. But
okay.
If you're looking in procedures, the different... The distinction being that there's cash donations and non-cash donations. There's the classification C1, the classification C2, and then there's N1 through 1 through 6. I delineated out the classes a little bit further than this policy did, and I tried to make everything into a more of a policy form than this, which is more like kind of instructions. But if you wanted to just kind of start out and go through it, because I think that there are some things specifically in, if you look at Bob's document, where it starts to have like authority, IRS authority, donor types, donations defined, I didn't quite get through adding all of these to this, but there are, it's very much in line with the county's policy. I felt the most comfortable doing that too, just because Bob had spoken about how they implemented this policy after there were some specific issues, which means I know that County Council has definitely vetted this policy.
Based on the policy that's in place?
Bob's.
Bob's, my understanding is this is the county's policy. And it includes a copy of the county's receipt form. It looks like what he did from having come through it is that he command-F'd the county and replaced it with district. This command-F supervisors and replaced it with directors.
Yeah.
The comment
I'll make is that Bob does seem to have thought a lot about this, and Bob does seem to have a good command of the issues, and I kind of trust him on this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, I actually think you're right, because on the last page, if you look under N4, a description of how the donation will be used for county operations or other county purposes.
Yep. Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
See that, and that's what I'm speaking of. So then on I think it's the last page. I don't know if it like made it into this one, but he had the sample receipt.
I just put in the different orders to.
Yeah. No. Oh, sweet. Oh, so it is in there. Oh, okay. So yeah, I mean, obviously, like I didn't make our own receipt. Like that will be something that. Whoever is charged with receiving the donations would have to create, but the template for what needs to go on a receipt is defined. It is defined under Procedure 4 4D, or no, not 4D, I'm sorry. Where did this go? It's definitely defined. Procedure number two, if the donation is appropriate, a completed receipt must be given to the donor indicating the estimated value of the donation, date, name of the donor, donor type, donor address, purpose of donation, donation classification as defined below, and type of donation.
I'm sorry, I'm still confused by one thing. So we've got Bob's recommendations, which was just the counties with some search and replace, and then what is your document?
It's this, but it's, I tried to make it so that it would fit more with the district.
Okay, all right.
In cool. specific, one of the things that I did is that there's something, I have a lot here, let me find it. So it references, because there are some, obviously, once you start getting into donors who want to be tax exempt, there are some forms that need to be filled out, some IRS forms, particularly the form 8283. And that would require that someone from the district sign off on that form, either whether it is in agreement that they are agreeing that a specific thing that's being donated to the district is valued at a certain price, or to receive forms for the district's own tax purposes. So what I have is this position called the financial officer. That's the most broad thing that I could come up with, because I didn't want to designate a role that the board hasn't designated yet. But I think that any part of a recommendation should be that we recommend the board either create a position to handle the processing of these, or designate a director or an officer position, whatever it is, to handle the processing of these, because that is the whole policy is all for naught if there's not a way to process them.
And do you think that direction should be within the policy? Or do you think...
No, it should be a separate... We can make recommendations that aren't necessarily policies.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to think of what else it was that I did that was different than Bob's. The introduction is different. I borrowed a lot from the city policy in the introduction. But the introduction is mainly just kind of...
City of Santa Barbara? Mm-hmm. No, that the earlier city
it's,
you mentioned. That
it's just called... It's just. It was just called city donations. It didn't specify which city. And I can... See if I can pull that up in a moment.
Should we do a read through of what you have right now?
I think because I'm kind of struggling to remember what is important and what's not. Let's just do a read through. I can start off. Under Internal Revenue Service Code Section 170C1 and California Government Code Section 61116 Section A, the district may accept donations as charitable contributions. Individuals, companies, or organizations may wish to donate money, items, or services to the district as a public service. Donations include cash or any item, physical or digital, such as equipment, books, digital photos, etc., or service, such as staff time, donated for utilization by the district. The district recognizes the value of donations from individuals and organizations and affirms that they provide a unique opportunity for community involvement to enhance the district and the community. Acceptance of a donation requires that the accounting and Internal Revenue Service statutes and regulations, as described in later sections, be followed by the district. A donation of any amount may be presented to the Board of Directors for acceptance or rejection if the Board determines that doing so would serve the public interest. So that clause in particular, I want to kind of focus on that one, because later on we're going to go into the procedures and we're going to talk about what the threshold is for a donation to automatically have to receive Board of Directors approval. This clause in the policy just says that if a director says, hey, this donation of $4,000 for whatever, or this bicycle is being donated to us, this is weird, or just wants to review it and wants it to be a matter of the public record, they can just request that... that be determined something like that the board approval would be a matter of the public interest, and then it would have to receive board approval. The threshold for that, generally speaking, is $10,000, whether you're talking about cash items or non-cash items. The other things to note...
if it's less than that, then it doesn't go for board approval, or it is not...
It doesn't automatically go for board approval. The other things are the two sections of code, IRS code 170C1 and government code 61116A. There's so many ones, I'm like getting dyslexia looking at them. But the government code is what specifically gives us the authority to accept donations. And the IRS code, I believe, does something similar, but I forget exactly what, because I haven't looked at this in a while. I can continue on if there are no questions. Does anyone have a question? Okay. Donations. One, a donation is defined as a voluntary transfer of money or tangible item without compensation to a charity or public institution. A transfer that stipulates advertising, marketing, or other quid pro quo in return for the transfer is not a donation and is beyond the scope of this policy. So in Bob's, this had a clause in it that said, where it says, and is beyond the scope of this policy, before it said, the transfer is not a donation, it is a sponsorship, and is beyond the scope of this policy. But sponsorship was in quotes, and we don't have a policy on sponsorship, so I just figured we struck that for now.
Does the county have a policy on sponsorships? I would have just taken that.
I would imagine that they do if they have a policy on donations.
I was just taking that little side comment that they were making there as simply explanation to somebody who thinks it's a donation. It's like, no, you're being sponsored by us if you think you're getting a mention or something. Mm-hmm. So
I to be honest, to answer your question, I don't know if the county has a policy on sponsorships. I think it's unnecessary for us to have that in there. That would be beyond the scope of the
policy. I have a question with the first sentence there.
Yes.
Donation is defined as a voluntary transfer of money or tangible item without compensation to a charity or public institution. Should there be individual there?
No, it's two. So this is actually background. Like, this sentence is just like kind of describing the situation to the reader, that the IRS defines a donation as a voluntary transfer of money or tangible item without compensation to a charity, which is not what we're defining here,
so
or a public institution, which is us.
Cool.
So should we find the code section in the IRS code that defines what a donation is and just throw the code in there? Or is that not necessary?
I think we already listed the
listed.
Yeah.
Okay. Number two, donations are not to be accepted from individuals or agencies where acceptance will require the donor to receive a substantial benefit from the district or will allow the donor to determine policy or to exert influence on the district. Three, donations may be accepted directly from taxpayers, such as individuals, partnerships, and corporations, or from 501c3 nonprofit entities. Four.
But not 501c4s.
Those are political...
Political
got it.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Their action, like the action funds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There are other 501c's. Like, there's one that's just like a. Well, because some of them are just like, I'm a for-profit company that is still doing things that are, you know, occasionally in the public good, and therefore you get like a different tax status.
If you wanted to look into adding other ones that you think it would be appropriate for us to accept donations from, that's fine. This is what the county had. Number four, the two categories of donations the district may accept are cash and non-cash, in parentheses, in-kind donations. Non-cash donations can include goods, supplies, equipment, vehicles, buildings, land, computer software, works of art, historical treasures, and other. Non-cash donations should have value to the district in its form for acceptance. Without each of these two categories exist different donation classification, or within each of these two categories exist different donation classifications. And the last sentence of that was added by me.
Wait, what was added by you?
Within each of these two categories exist different donation classifications. So I'm referencing the NC1, NC2, those. Five. Individual items with a value less than $10,000 from the same donor would not meet the $10,000 threshold requiring Board of Directors acceptance. A pledge of $10,000 or greater, but paid in installments, does qualify. So now we are starting to get into the area where I left off, because I did the procedures before I did this.
And so you got that from the county?
Yeah, that's straight out of the county. I think there was something in there that I left out because it didn't make a whole lot of sense to me.
You left out six.
That's six. Oh, I definitely left that. Yeah. I don't know, even know what six was. So then we start getting into acceptance of who accepts the donation. If you look at the 1, 2, 3, 4th down on Bob's county policies, it's called acceptance timing. It states donations shall be officially accepted by the general manager, and then quote president or vice president until a GM is hired of the IVCSD or the board of directors prior to placing the donation in use. The district may have physical possession of the donation prior to official acceptance, but must return the donation if not accepted. So, I think just in, are we comfortable with that? Because the reason I left that out is because there's the delineation of roles. What do we all think about that?
Well, since the vice president acts in the absence of the president, perhaps just this the president, and rather than until a GM is hired, maybe in the absence of a general manager.
I like that.
That's good.
That sounds fancy.
Because that's saying, like, right now we don't have one, but also in the future there may be, well, we would hope we'd have some interim coverage, but...
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that would be a way to phrase it to serve our needs now and serve our needs in the future.
Okay, so you had president. Okay, what do we think of this? Well,
lowercase or?
Good call.
So the original text was actually also included or the board of directors, I guess as a group, in the form of a vote.
Donations shall be officially accepted by the general manager of the IVCSD or the board of directors prior to placement. Oh, so the reason
sense.
That I took that out is because I assumed that Bob threw that in after the fact to be consistent with his other thing that he threw in, president or vice president until a GM is hired, but...
I think he threw it in based on the... differentiation of whether a donation has to come before the board
okay.
or whether it can just be done by the general manager based on the amount threshold. Is that what how you saw it?
That is consistent with what I had not actually thought through why
okay.
you put that there.
I think that's why he put it.
Yeah.
Well, because I mean, like, what is official acceptance? Is it something that is declared? Is it something that is signed? What do you think? Official acceptance.
I'm not sure that that would be defined here.
Okay. I can put it back. I get the angle that you're...
Well, it sounds like we have to put it back based on Ethan's comment, because
right.
there are some things that the board has to approve, and so they can't be accepted
okay.
by the general manager.
Yeah, which is stated right above in
yeah.
5. So, conveniently placed.
Okay.
Wait. Oh, yeah. May. That's correct. Yeah.
Okay. So the next one is donation solicitation. District directors or staff must avoid any actual or perceived conflict of interest surrounding donations. All donations must be made, and any actions taken by district officials or employee must be with complete impartiality and without favoritism, and the appearance of partiality or favoritism must be avoided. For example, the district must not solicit donations from organizations over which they may have regulatory or enforcement authority. the district is required to only pursue donations consistent with a public purpose that is within the scope of the district's responsibilities, strategic plans, and policy.
I like it.
Trying to think through scenarios where we would be trying to do something with the community center or something that would involve us doing some kind of weird fundraising drive or something. But yeah, we shouldn't be doing those.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The CDC is doing the community center fundraising drive.
Do it.
And it goes back to the thing where, like, here with such a small town, this 1 square mile that we're involved in the governance with.
Wait, but not even through them. Like,
yeah.
They want to do something, they do it, they organize it, they run it, and nothing to do with us. It's great.
Yeah, yeah. We've been on the community center thing
for
like a year now.
And that's also, like, IVPIC is super associated with the IVRPD, but doesn't report to the board, and that's why they can actively fundraise in Isla Vista for parks projects.
Yeah, but I was actually, parks are at least still within the scope of the district's responsibilities. I was like trying to come up with weird scenarios whereby we would be working on some kind of funny project, but we can't. And so that's why it's just entirely up to you.
Yeah.
Don't tell us.
But I think like
you're not even allowed to. It's impertinent.
Yeah, I mean, I think this makes it clear though, like, really a lot of the organizations that are working in Isla Vista, it would be improper for us to contact, even if we do have a lot of shared priorities, if it's clear that we are involved in governance over that subject area, we should.
Well, that's the first part of this.
But they can still come to us unsolicited, right? That's not prohibited.
Yeah.
By this. Cool.
Yeah.
So the only thing, what do we want to do with the phrase about staff at the beginning? Do we want to leave that in there? Or do we not want to reference staff since we don't have any staff?
Oh, district directors or staff.
If you want to go back to the Google Doc, I pasted it on there.
I think it's okay for us to have that.
So, I don't know if this matters. It's a level of indirection, so it probably doesn't. But let's say that we got this strategy that's been going on about trying to ask people to voluntarily pay the utility users tax. So, in a way, that's like a mass solicitation for a donation that arguably has some leaning to it because we've got some authority over everybody, and there might be a implied threat or power dynamic to the fact that, like, well, what happens if you don't? And we're not saying we don't want to do anything to the people who don't, but technically we could.
I was going to say, it says organization.
That's.
I don't think the district has enforcement authority over people, too.
Okay. But so one thought process that occurred to me was if you were to go to Cerezo's or you were to go to Deja Vu and ask them for tax money. Not tax money.
Right.
Pseudo-tax money.
Donation.
A donation in lieu of a tax money.
But, I mean, I don't think we have that regulatory or enforcement. Like, I think the Foot Patrol might be one where...
Yeah.
We don't have regulation over, but like you could see like us having a contract with them could be something.
The thing I was thinking of was code enforcement.
Code enforcement.
But even that is still a contract, and we're not the ones who would be managing police officers.
Yeah.
They wouldn't be employees of us.
It
would be a contract with the county, a contract with the county in both scenarios.
Yeah. And one other thing too, and I know this is not a decision to make right now, but if the CDC was getting the donations and then giving lump sum donations to the CSD, then we could go to like Cerezo because they would be donating it to a 501c3, and then we'd be like, oh, it's just one big pool of money that we're giving you. Like, it's our money now.
That's why I mentioned the level of indirection. But I feel like the goal of this clause is to the goal of this entire section, in a way, except for maybe the
last part is to deal with corruption and harassment issues. I'd like to make certain that we don't end up in a situation and directing you to talk to somebody instead of us doing it directly is just us bypassing our policy on anti-corruption. So it's not like it doesn't solve the problem. Like we don't have to have this policy. Right. We can just strike this policy and then just go start talking to them.
Yeah. Well, I think it's different if the board solicits the IVCDC and says, "Hey, can you please do this? Like, this is our project. We want you to take it on."
Mm-hmm. But in this case, it's like we could just say, I mean, that Jonathan came to us, which he did, with this idea.
Yeah. Exactly.
And then, okay.
So again, yeah, I think the general theme here is just. Cool. Be careful with your solicitation as directors.
Yeah, and I'm very comfortable that since the county had this in place, this is probably good practice.
I agree.
I mean, I think that sentence about the regulatory or enforcement authority, perhaps it doesn't really fit our district, but I don't think by having that in there it hurts us at all. I think if anything, it's adding extra protection.
Cool.
Okay.
So I'm confused that we were reading from your Google Doc, and now we're reading from the...
Yes, because this is the point at which I left off, and I hadn't copied and pasted.
But you have more stuff after this.
There is. I started
okay, right.
For different
bottom.
Sections, though, right?
I started with the procedures, and then I went back and started to do this kind of like more definitional stuff.
Cool.
So, if you want to go back to the Google Doc, it is...
No, I just wanted to understand... Because I was staring at the Google Doc, and I'm like, wait, I don't know what he's reading anymore. And then I'm like, okay, he's reading.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'll delineate that. So now I'm back on the county's policy for appraisals and valuations.
Oh. Wait. By county policy, you mean the Google Doc? Or the...
No. Right. The Google Doc would be mine.
Oh, I see. This was my fault. I needed to scroll left. Because I scrolled the titles.
Oh,
off,
yeah.
I was
yeah.
just not looking.
Okay,
got it.
All right. Appraisals valuations. If a donor estimates that a non-cash donation has a value of $5,000 or more, an appraisal is necessary if the donation is other than supplies or materials. The appraisal cost cannot be added to the estimated value of the item. Additionally, the cost and the pursuit of the appraisal should be the responsibility of the donor. The reference to, quote, qualified appraisals in this document is in accordance with IRS Publication 561, available at www.irs.gov. Supplies and materials that are new and have never been placed in service prior to the donation may be valued with purchase receipts provided by the donor as long as the elapsed time of transfer would not have affected the value.
Cool.
So there are a lot of interesting things in this one. Particularly, well, I'll start off with the supplies and materials, which, frankly, I was very pleased to see that this was sort of an exception that the county had in place, because right now, as we kind of discussed at the last board meeting, like the supplies and appraisals, or I'm sorry, the supplies and materials thing is like a lot of what has been informally donated to the district through your service or through Susan Yamashiro with the university, or like me or Ethan printing stuff from Pardall Center or from my own home printer. So I think that we're in a good place with that. Also, the appraisals, of course, as we'll see in the procedures, there is the threshold, namely the $10,000 threshold, or I'm sorry, the $5,000 threshold. And it's, I think, important that it's delineated that the appraisal is the responsibility of the donor and not the district. But other than that, I think that this is in a good place.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty comfortable with it as well.
I'm going to copy and paste it. Then we have exclusions, which I did post in here, so that would be number 10. Or now it's number 9, because I deleted 9, if you're back on my document. The following items are excluded from the acceptance or rejection requirements of the proposed policy. This should be a colon. Volunteer service hours. These are not considered donations since these services are not allowable as IRS charitable deductions and their value is not reported on district financial records. However, the district will periodically acknowledge volunteer service hours as matter of public interest. B. Shared cost programs. Programs that share the cost of a district project with individuals or agencies resulting in a benefit for both the district and the cost sharer. These are not considered donations since the individual or other agency is receiving something from the district in return for their contribution. C. Operating or capital grants.
I like that.
I do too. I'm gonna make this a little more consistent.
Yeah, and I think the shared cost programs, I feel like programs that we do in coordination with the university, even though shared cost, I don't know if it fully accurately describes it because it would more be our intention, their cost. But I think that would fall under this, and operating your capital grants is awesome that that would be separate from this as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So then once it gets to that, we're into procedures. The county thing has a reference to their sample donation receipt, but we don't need to put that in the policy. Again, that'll be something that's at the discretion of whoever is charged with processing these. Number one, all donations must be made in compliance with California Government Code Section 8100 at SEC. So this is something I added in there. That's the Political Reform Act. And it just specifies some things about donations. Let me see if I can pull it up briefly.
And are you putting this in before we get to procedures for cash and procedures for non-cash?
Yes. Do you see on the... I'm sorry, you want to go back? Oh, wait, no, you are here. Wait. No, to back
you're saying that on yours? I'm saying on theirs they have procedure for cash and then here.
Yeah, where did that come from? Did that come from
one
of the
cities? I'm saying I put that in there.
Okay.
I put that in there in response to something I believe it was something I read in another policy manual that referenced the Political Reform Act, and I started to look a little bit more about some of the things that it had in there regarding donations, and I thought it would just be a good boilerplate to have at the beginning of this policy. I should have bookmarked the things that had to do with donations. See if I can briefly find it right now. But there are, I mean, of course, I'm sure you're both familiar with the intent of the Political Reform Act and different things to make sure that things are being done in the public interest and they're not fighting corruption and everything like that. Two. If the donation is appropriate, a completed receipt must be given to the donor, indicating the estimated value of the donation, date, name of the donor, donor type, donor address, purpose of donation, donation classification as defined below, and type of donation.
I like it. But question, should we add to that number one if we're mentioning all donations must be made in compliance with Political Reform Act section? Should we also mention the IRS code and government code sections that we mentioned in the beginning of the document?
Let's do it. I think it's a great idea.
Because I'm guessing those give us more than just, or I'm guessing those are in place for reasons other than just giving us authority, but for also reasons of.
So it does set some guidelines.
So I'm sorry, I actually am missing a piece of context, which is a Political Reform Act application to donations to a district. In what way? I totally believe you, I don't.
Oh, as far as
I'm
accepting donations that would influence a public official or public agency's actions.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
So my point here was we should expand it to all the different things that they must comply with. Or at least the other ones that are mentioned here for consistency.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I went through number two. Number three. If the donation is a cash donation of less than $10,000, classification C1, the district shall A, provide a receipt to the donor, B, deposit the money into the district treasury in a timely manner, C, complete a budget provision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue. And four, if the donation is a cash donation of $10,000 or more, classification C2, the district shall A, provide a receipt to the donor, B, deposit the money into the district treasury in a timely manner, C, complete a budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue, D, require the district submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1, the amount of the donation, 2, the name of the donor, 3, the circumstances of the donation, 4, any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5, a description of how the donation will be used by the district, 6, the budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue.
Interesting. I thought that we couldn't accept donations if it has a caveat or obligation.
And yes, and that's the first thing that I thought when I read that too. I think that is just for extra protection to like remind us like that we can't do that.
Okay.
Would you mind sharing me on this as well?
So oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's been very helpful to follow along.
Yeah, sorry, I totally forgot about
just
you.
So, I could.
So I'm going to share it to your Ethan.
Is
it ebertrand.ivcsd@gmail.com.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, so I thought the same exact thing when I saw that. I'm going to continue real quickly. E, action by the board will result, board capitalized, will result in the recording of acceptance or rejection in the board of directors' minutes. Rejection will result in the donation being returned to its rightful owner. So basically, the way that it was written at Bob's was just like classification C2 is everything in C1 and then this stuff. But I thought better if we just delineated it all out.
No apostrophe.
I'm sorry, where?
It is rightful owner.
Oh, my bad. 5. If the donation is a non-cash donation of less than $5,000, classification N1, the district shall A, provide a receipt to the donor that includes the value of the donation as agreed upon by the district and the donor to be less than $5,000. 6. If
but when it says as agreed upon by the district, is that as agreed upon by
the board?
The board or by the.
So that's another thing.
The
or
the general manager slash president.
In all places of which I could, I just swapped out a role, like a personnel role, for just the word district. We
okay.
can. Is there. If there's a
also
specific
for,
person that you want to. Delegate that to? I mean, I know that earlier in this policy,
cash donations less than $5,000, I'm thinking that we don't want to have to continually bring that back
to the board.
But I think as the I think since we already defined the threshold before, I think by saying the district, it that gives room for if it's under the threshold, that would be made by the general manager or in their absence, the president. Not having to come to the board.
That was just for approving it, though, right? Not for.
Well, that's another thing. So later in this, I reference just this position that I just willy-nilly created, which is this financial officer position or whatever I ended up calling it.
Which we don't have and we can't willy-nilly create.
Which we don't have and we can't willy-nilly create.
Just want to throw that out there.
Yeah. It was created as a placeholder. As an acknowledgement.
Are you sure we write a policy about it? Then we essentially just force
it's there,
the
it's there.
To vote on it and then make one.
It was created as a placeholder as a recognition that there are roles that need to be fulfilled that we could delegate them to the president. It was, like I said, it's a placeholder.
Cool.
These are different thresholds, right? So the threshold for board acceptance was $10,000, and then this is a threshold. Wait, no, it also is $5,000. $5,000 for non-cash. So it's a different threshold, and it is, I think, a different activity. So I think the way as written, you would essentially, this is the one that I am particularly interested in because this is the one where I'm wondering, like every time I.
Yeah.
Print out things like, do I
mm-hmm.
need to be going and giving a receipt to somebody? Should
uh-huh.
I should, do I bringing a $20 receipt to
uh-huh.
the board for approval seems weird.
Well, and as you will see below, breaching that threshold, whether or not you need to bring that receipt and file those forms is dependent on whether or not you would like to claim it as tax deductible, as a charitable contribution, which we're about to get into with number six. If the donation is a non-cash contribution of $5,000 or greater and less than $10,000 and is received from a taxpayer, the district shall A. determine if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution on their tax form, classification N2. Then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations. B. require the donor complete IRS form 8283. C. sign off on the IRS form 8283. D. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount. E. forward a copy of the appraisal and the completed form 8283 to the district designated financial officer for proper classification in the district's financial statements. So again, here is my placeholder person. And then back up. 2. If the donor is not going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution on their tax form, classification N3, then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies. B. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount.
But so that distinction only matters for the greater than $5,000 case, and even still does not change whether it's less than or greater than $5,000, whether it's claimed or not. A receipt is supposed to be provided by the district. And that receipt also probably affects essentially, like, I don't know if the right term is revenue, but it affects like the amount of money that the district is thinking that it is receiving, even in terms of like it has utilized in some manner. And so, like as currently written, I cannot opt out of receiving a receipt if I donate something non-cash to the district. Somebody has to give me a receipt. I mean, I am willing, by the way, to not receive. Yeah, I'm just like that. I'm just bringing this up because this is like I read this when Bob presented it, and I'm like, oh wow, okay, this affects me. Let's figure this out.
Yeah. No, I think it's definitely a relevant discussion to have. And there are certain things in the counties where you can opt out of a receipt. And I don't see any reason why there can't be something put in place that allows the donor to voluntarily opt out of a receipt.
And
what do you think?
One thing that just hit me in the head, though, was in the case of you making donations in various ways as you have, does there need to be a defined in this policy a protocol for when directors make donations separate from when individuals or organizations do? Because even though we can say we're making a donation as an individual, it is so close to our board duties and our board mm-hmm. responsibilities that I think perhaps that is something to define, and we can see if other districts or local government agencies have made a policy with that. Mm-hmm. And maybe even that could say if there wanted to be something where board members can opt out.
I would have just assumed that board members making donations was equivalent to people making donations. It's just that if you're going to vote on it, I should, for example, then leave the room while you vote on whether you approve my donation or not. But. I mean, another like, you know, complexity here is that, I mean, as it currently stands, I am effectively just arbitrarily making donations to the point where it's just like, whether you wanted it or not, I spent money on something.
Are we implying acceptance by, like, reading through the papers and not getting mad at you for doing so? But, yeah, I see what you mean. Mind if we take a quick break so I can use the restroom?
Go for it.
We can mull this over.
So, should we official break or not?
It doesn't matter to me. If you guys want to continue to talk, but go ahead.
We can also just stop talking. But I only bring it up like are we going so informal now that I will like edit this out of the video that I may post later? Or is this
take your time and let's just wait until he gets back.
Okay.
But does I mean he's done a great job and. Plugging this all into a policy.
I'm so thankful.
Yeah, because I mean, I really appreciated how Bob presented it, but It took a little vision to narrow it into a policy format, which I'm glad we've gotten the ball on rolling.
While you run up the room, we have expressed our appreciation to you.
Yeah. Oh. I guess we can do that now as well.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah, like...
Ethan brought it up.
When I saw this at first, it's kind of overwhelming just how awesome this information is, as it was initially compiled, so it's really cool to get it in a policy format.
Yeah. Not a problem. I figured we should know what we're working on. Yeah, because that was the other thing. Initially, I wasn't sure if this was just, like, instructions that were distributed to different departments of the county, or if this was the actual policy, because it doesn't look like a policy. It looks more like instructions. But as I was reading through it, I thought there's no reasons why it can't be the basis of a policy. And Bob did make some formatting adjustments to it, so I don't think it was all just copy and paste. Anyone deserves appreciation. It's certainly him for giving this to us.
We did say that one at the beginning of this agenda item, though.
That's right.
Really bomb.
That's right. Let the record show. So, what do we think about an opt-out for receipts?
Another option is like from the perspective of like the stuff that I do is just restructuring it the way that I do this. Like instead of providing occasional random copies, what I should do is I should buy a bunch of materials, donate them to the districts, and then offer printing service for free. And then the paper goes back to me, and then I print stuff, and then I've got a little pile of paper that the district owns that I know that is your paper.
Yeah, and that so way, in that case, you'd still be donating a service.
No,
not if we direct you to do it.
Yeah, and a service is not.
We direct him to use his own like private equipment to do something.
Well, if the cost was donated in bulk up front, and then we direct Director Freeman to print materials.
Yeah.
Because right now it's been informal.
So if we donated him, materials and services of printing.
Well, there's services divided into two segments. Part of services is like wear and tear on equipment, and that is either non-understandable or is something that I could actually like put an appraisal of ahead of time. And then the other part of it is my time printing, and that's actually, there's a term for it,
yeah.
Like me volunteering. And so that's not a donation.
Okay.
But also, if you were acting under board direction,
and so.
I'm just saying, I don't know if it gets around the.
Well, it doesn't get around anything. It just makes this non-onerous in the sense that like I could essentially just go make one trip to Staples, come back, get one receipt, and then we don't have to worry about this going forward. It doesn't turn into like
me
constantly asking for stupid middly receipts.
Yeah.
Because I do think that for most donations, we are going to want to give a receipt. I think cases where we're not are going.
I mean,
to
I think so too. I mean, yeah, I think so too. If only for our own financial records. Yeah. Well, once the policy's in place, then directors who are currently providing services can make adjustments.
Yeah,
I'm certain they will.
That's cool.
Okay. So, let's see, 5, 6. Okay, so reading through down to section 7. If the donation is a non-cash donation, bless you, of $5,000 or greater and less than $10,000 and is received from a 501c3 classification N4, the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount. So in this specific case, the thing I think that comes to all of our minds is services provided to us by the IBCBC. And one thing that I'd also like to point out just about how that this policy would interact with something like that is something else that's stated that we already kind of parsed through. If you scroll up, that individual items with a value of less than $10,000 from the same donor would not meet the $10,000 threshold requiring board acceptance. A pledge of $10,000 or greater but paid in installments does qualify. So there is a distinction between a individual, be it a organization, a 501c3 organization, or a taxpayer, and whether or not they're paying in installments or whether they are saying, I'm giving you this, and now, later down the line, I'm giving you this.
Wait, sorry, what's the distinction? The rules for a nonprofit donating between $5,000 and $10,000 is the same as the rules for an individual donating between $5,000 and $10,000 if they do not want a tax.
Yes, what I'm just talking about is the amount of, like, the accumulation of donations. Mm-hmm. And
the accumulation of donations isn't it just says from the same donor. It doesn't specify whether it's an individual or.
Yeah. Well, what I'm just saying is that, as we go forward, like I said, because we're, I think, thinking about this item in the context of CDC.
Yeah.
There's a distinction between them, like, providing us services that are worth $10,000 or more in installments, and them providing us with individual services, each of which value less than $10,000. I just wanted to point that out.
This is not a service.
Individual items. Well, items.
I think actually the non-cash donations are goods, supplies, equipment, vehicles, buildings, land, computer software, works of art, historical treasures. It would have to be somewhere there was a section on non-cash donations.
Okay. Again. Well, maybe I threw. Then there may be some inconsistency because I did add some language about services somewhere, and my computer just died, so. Does anyone
help me
have a charger?
Save a friend.
I don't know if yours will work with mine, because you have an older one.
I think this is your same.
Who is it?
That looks so. Ethan's looks like the older one. You said you have an older one.
I have a newer one.
Newer one.
Yeah. Yes,
maybe
this
not.
Is the older one. Yeah.
And humorously, I've got an even newer one.
There's an even newer
I've got
one.
Mine's USB-C.
Oh wow!
So,
we're just on in different generations, yeah. Everybody. That's okay. I can follow along. So,
you already the beginning of this. It did say or services.
And I'm telling you that I'm the one
yeah.
who added that language
cool.
in there.
No. That was in Bob's. Bob's actually at the beginning said. Money, goods, money grants, goods, or services. So there was the word services as a thing.
Okay, cool.
So
if we need to go amend definitions to include services, I mean, I certainly think that we can. A service to me certainly seems like a non-cash donation if someone is donating us services.
This entire clause to me just seems so weird. It's like, if you're going to donate a helicopter, you could either, the helicopter costs more than $10,000, that would require acceptance. But if you donate a helicopter door, and then you donate a helicopter propeller blade, and then you donate a, it's like, well, those are all cheap items, and somehow they add up to a helicopter. It's not that you didn't provide us installments for a helicopter. You just provided us a bunch of parts individually over the course of a month for a helicopter. Like,
yeah. I do like the adding up thing because it reminds me of with our
FPPC one.
Yeah, with our 4700.
That's what I was
requirement.
Thinking too.
If it's under the maybe one meal or one sort of gift is by far less than the requirement at which
but if you buy me
you
like
need
every
to,
single day
to report. But yeah, so I do think adding up it does qualify.
Yeah, and if you want me to read the actual language, because this is something that I amended because it confused me, maybe you like it better the way
let's
that it was.
The
it's the third on attachment B, which is Bob's. It's called donation threshold. Individual items with a value of less than $10,000 from the same donor would not meet the $10,000 threshold requiring board of director acceptance. Additionally, if the total from the same donor sums to $10,000 or more as a random circumstance during the fiscal year. That's the language I didn't like. I'm sure you'll appreciate that. This total would not be required to be accepted by the board of directors. A pledge of $10,000 or greater but paid in installments does qualify. So I think that
it just feels nonsensical to me.
It feels like redundant or like explaining to people how they would get around the policy if they wanted to.
I like it.
I mean, yeah, I understand where you're coming from as someone who likes to think of ways to get around rules when we would sit in meetings about Deltopia and the university would talk about Spring Insight. I kept on thinking about how I would come to Deltopia as an out-of-towner and where I would park my car if I was a nefarious high schooler.
Right outside the store.
Apparently so.
That's where I park Deltopia. A lot of people go to my apartment.
I think that, again, there is a policy that says that if a director wants something to come before the board of directors for acceptance, and essentially what that policy does is say, like, if there's something that needs light shed on it, it can receive that light in the board public context.
But this is more like designed to be, my thought, a policy to make certain that in a way that happens. Because so with the general manager, I think it's more clear. Like, you've got the general manager, and the general manager is you know, just receiving a bunch of donations occasionally because it's useful to receive those donations, and it's just providing receipts for them. And then one day you find out that person's actually like provided half the funding of the district over time, mm-hmm. and has actually had some weird level of influence that hasn't really been noticed by the board because it's been occurring inside the staff level of the whole thing. And it's like, mm-hmm. this is more of a policy to make certain that the general manager is like, okay, you've now triggered our $10,000 per year donation thing. I'm going to have to go to the board in order to make certain that I can accept this donation.
And that's a good thing to have, right?
Yeah, I like that. But the thing I'm saying that I don't like is this weird thing that says that individual items are less than it if they are, actually the wording is clear here.
Yeah.
That
you can literally sit on the end of this table.
Yeah, it is the individual. Yeah, this is we can't let you vote, but you can totally
yeah.
sit with us. I will ask if you're willing to sit on Spencer's side.
Do you happen to have a charger?
No, I don't. Well,
okay.
I need it.
Oh, yeah, I do. Why, were you not here for that?
I was in the bathroom.
He was
like,
oh,
seconds.
That's where you were. Okay, yeah, sorry.
Yeah. Is your computer dead?
It is.
You need to use mine?
No, it's
okay,
it's
but
fine.
What was the part?
Oh, yeah,
so
my issue is this whole thing about how if they're individual items from the same donor, then they don't total. And I don't really understand what it means to have. I like totaling. I think you said you liked totaling. Maybe I misunderstood.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah,
and
this clause is about how it's is about not totaling.
Yeah. Well,
the random circumstance kind of is counter to what you like, because
right,
said,
that's what I'm saying. Yeah,
oh,
I don't,
you
want to
take
I'm,
that out.
And so specifically, this is what the county has.
Yeah, well,
if you want to go back, this
yeah.
is what I had to take out the random circumstances.
Yeah,
I didn't like that.
But it's the sentence
but
here
it's
that's
similar.
Just clarifying that individual items with a value of less than $10,000 from the same donor, I would have said, would meet the $10,000 threshold requiring board of director approval.
So, Well, I guess here's where we decide what do we think is best for the district. Do we think that, or what do we think we should recommend to be best? Do we think that we want it where, if anything, if someone's donated 10,000 or right under 10,000, any additional donations that they make in, I guess, a calendar year would have to come before the board? Is that what we're looking for?
Keeping in mind that any donation can come before the board if the director wants it to.
Right, but the thing is that the goal of the threshold, I would argue, is to ensure that the board knows that it's happening. Because again, it's like, normally it would either be just Ethan or just none of us, you know, the fictional general manager who's taking on them. Mm-hmm. And so there's no mechanism by which it's possible that no board member even knows that we've accepted $100,000 in donations from somebody. Mm-hmm. I mean, alternatively,
do you think? I'm leaning towards just striking the word "not." I mean,
opposite.
Yeah, like I mean, the more that I think about this, I think you're right, Jay.
But saying individual items with a value less than 10,000 from the same donor would.
Oh well, we'd have to.
You have to add some like.
Yeah, yeah.
Could
compounding.
Could.
It says value less, and then it says could meet the amount.
Yeah,
like, I don't think
could
that
compound.
Book.
Yeah, there it is. Well, at that point, the could should just be a would.
All
right. Again, right?
Yeah, the could should be a would. Less than $10,000 from the same donor.
Should it be made clear multiple individual items?
Take out the comma. Multiple individual items with value less than $10,000 from the same donor totaling greater than $10,000 during a calendar year would meet the $10,000 threshold requiring a board of directors acceptance. A pledge of $10,000 or greater paid in installments does qualify.
We don't even need that anymore.
We don't need that at all if we go that direction.
Well, then you'd have to put individual items or donations, right? Because items is like
items are
cash.
Items are the things. Actually, that's a good question. Yeah, that's better.
You want to put multiple individual donations like from the same source?
That's here.
Maybe
does read better if we put that first.
Looks good.
Oh,
with a combined value?
Each with a value.
Okay.
And then it says totaling greater than 1,000.
Would you want to put totaling 10,000 and more? Because that's been, I think, that was what
earlier.
Was 10,000. Wait, but what? It just said greater than, though.
But what if it was exactly 10,000 and no
okay.
Yeah.
Earlier?
Because that's the language I was using, too. I said 10,000 or more.
Do we need any mention of pledge in there, though? Saying that a pledge would still trigger it, even if it's not.
Oh, there. If someone came and said we're doing a pledge of act, yeah. Then it would be weird, like, oh, we're doing a pledge of 2,000 each, and then you'd only wait until the last one to approve it.
Yeah.
Qualify. Right.
For board approval.
Rather than will qualify, should it be will require?
Require. That's the language we've been using.
So I feel like it should either be a separate clause or I add the word also. Are you okay with me adding the word also?
I'm
feels
fine
weird.
With
that's
that.
Fine.
Okay.
Can you put approval? Because that's the language we're using.
Oh, this one is also approval.
No, it's probably good for acceptance.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Multiple individual donations from the same donor, each with a value of less than $10,000, totaling $10,000 or greater during a calendar year, would meet the $10,000 threshold requiring board of directors' acceptance. A pledge of $10,000 or greater that will be paid in installments will also require board of directors' acceptance.
Would.
I have a question. Would you want to put something like it's, you know, it says once it gets this 10,000, because, you know, these multiple individual donations, you don't know when it's going to hit 10,000, so put like a semicolon after acceptance and be like, upon totaling. There it is. Easy. Way, way easier.
Hoping Bob is some incredible example where why we're wrong. Like, it'll just be fun.
Yeah, we really turned this one on its head.
Yeah.
We said, no, we're going to do the opposite of what you did, County. Yeah, that whole thing that's in the county policy about random circumstance during the fiscal year, I just don't get that.
They must have had a situation they were writing policy for.
Yeah. Well, Bob acknowledged that this whole thing was put in place because of some stuff that had happened. Helicopters was actually the thing that he said.
It was funny, I started talking to somebody else randomly about donations, and they also brought up, there was one time there was this helicopter.
I wonder how long ago that was. I'm going to have to go back.
How many special districts have a helicopter?
I know zero.
Maybe fired. Like the big like metropolitan water districts and power
energy. Oh, yeah.
But, okay.
To the water.
I think we're pretty good.
Yeah, this is good.
That number.
Good catch. Let's go back to towards the just further down to where we were, and I'll continue to read. My computer's dead now, so let's see. Okay, here's where we were, I believe. Up a little bit more.
I thought we did 7.
Oh, maybe we did do 7. If the donation is a non-cash donation of $10,000 or greater.
5,000 or greater, right?
No, he's reading
8. Oh, you're reading 8. Okay.
If the donation is a non-cash donation of $10,000 or greater and is received from a taxpayer, the district shall A, determine if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable deduction on their tax form. 1, if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution on their tax form, or maybe that should say deduction. Either way.
I'm guessing what's, because this classification N5, this is N4, I'm guessing this is like just pulled directly out of the IRS's law to provide policy.
No. I made it up.
You made up, wait, did
I
you
made
make
up,
a classification?
I made up the classifications because...
Oh, okay.
The classification, that is so that we, because that's
wait,
the same
it's
thing.
Referencing the same classifications as Bob provided.
No.
Oh,
I delineated more of them so that we could specifically reference them. So instead of saying, because what he had is he would have, this was just a me thing, he had like N2A and then N2B. And I just didn't like that because I thought it was unnecessary. And so I thought, why just not make it 1 through?
And is that was what he had, do you believe, just particular to how the county labeled it? Or do you think that came from the IRS? Protocol.
I actually did not think of that, to be honest with you. I guessed that it was
okay, so
the way the county.
We should probably
we should look
check
up,
that.
Let's look up gov code, and, or not gov code,
yes.
IRS code. Just Google like N-2, or N2 period B.
This is unrelated.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, was it? No. Probably not that. Seriously? It's because Google did that.
You can't command F a PDF that's open on Chrome?
Well, no, it didn't actually have OCR data, and what happened was that the so now what I need to do is I'm going to click.
And so Google doesn't do the OCR?
Google did the OCR and allowed me to search it with Google search, but now what I need to do is I'm going to bring up.
I'm not finding it on the publication 526, which is organizations that qualify to receive deductible contributions.
Well, so the letters N and C, they, in my mind, they were created as short for non-cash and cash, which are the two types of donations that we're talking about, which is another reason that I thought that it was just county policy.
Yeah.
So unless the IRS has a specific procedure on donations, that the government accepted donations, that had this kind of a classification.
Oh, it looks like here it says records to keep. You must keep your cash contributions, non-cash contributions, but it doesn't specify beyond that. But I'm not seeing any specification beyond cash and non-cash so far.
Uh-huh.
Let me see this.
Go ahead. That's the counties.
Yeah. So here, they do have some rules on types of deductions, but I think these are for the.
But they don't define a classification.
Yeah. They say, like, for this kind of situation, you have to do this. And for this kind of situation, you have to do that.
Yeah.
These are for, it's if you claim a deduction. So it's not like if the CSD is.
Yeah.
So.
And again, my understanding was that this was put in place to protect the agency, not to, legislate what the individual is going to do.
So this is some random website talking about IRS stuff, but it points out that when the claimed value of property exceeds $5,000, then the taxpayer must get a qualified appraisal, file section B of Form 8283, summary of the appraisal must be sent along with the tax returns. This like was related in some way to the stuff that the county is doing.
Oh yeah, well with the Form
8283.
Yeah.
And so it is, I do think that the correct term is contribution, to at least rewind back to that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It's good that we figured that out, because I was uncomfortable with having different ones.
I don't think we have two different ones. Or if we do, then
We had contribution for one of them, and then we had deductions was the other one.
Where does it say? So this one says
deduction
contribution.
Is under A. Deduction on there.
Oh, interesting. Okay,
I think it's probably called a charitable contribution deduction. Does it? Maybe we can find that one.
Yeah, because it also says contribution deduction here. Form 8283, non-cash charitable contribution.
I'm seeing charitable contribution deduction. Okay, that's the terminology we should use.
Yeah, figure the amount of your contribution deduction.
Cool.
And this is for the individual, right? Not for the district department?
Yeah, they do this.
Yeah, the district does have to sign off.
Or we have to sign.
In certain instances. At least that's part of what our policy says we have to do.
Don't need acknowledgement. Charitable
organization
acknowledges it is a qualified organization and that it received the donated property as described in Section B on the following date. Furthermore, the organization affirms that in the event it sells, exchanges, or otherwise disposes of the property described in Section B, Part 1, within 3 years after the date of receipt, it will form File 8282, donee information return with the IRS, and give the donor a copy of that form. This acknowledgement does not represent agreement with the claimed fair market value.
Okay. So something else before we get into that, the existence of this policy does not require that if someone comes to us and says, I want to donate this to you, that we have to accept it. I'm saying that just because of the fact that we are, in a sense, or we would be putting in place a policy that, like, for example, a policy that says that we have to co-sign on that form, the 8283. One of the things we have to provide is an employer identification number, which is not something that we currently have. It's something that the board directly...
Will we have that soon?
Say again?
Will we have that soon from the county?
We will have that as soon as the district has an address. I was directed to apply for that as the secretary, and one of the things that it asked for was an address, and I felt uncomfortable listing 1031 El Embarcadero.
Yeah, it's good.
So, yeah. Yeah. I know. It's a lot.
I'm sorry. It's just the idea that we're operating on such shoestring here. It's like, they have an address.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's something that I think we would be able to fulfill with a PL box or something. It's not within our jurisdiction to figure that stuff out. But the policy does not necessitate that we have to accept the donations.
Okay,
right.
Cool.
I will certainly be reminding everyone at the board level that we're not quite set up to do that yet. Okay, so let's see. Where are we?
We are somewhere in here. We were going to...
Do we want to change it be a charitable contribution deduction?
So that would be something we put here and here. And
wait, but go back if you can.
I've undone everything I did.
Okay, so in A, we have determined if the donor is going to claim the donation as charitable deduction on their tax form. Makes sense. If the donor is going to claim the donation as charitable contribution, I think if you add in A the contribution, but then don't change one at all, I think that might make sense. All
right. And then I also
Claiming a deduction. Or are you claiming the contribution? Because it says the same thing in both of them.
Well,
I think it should just be uniform.
What's
the difference?
What I see is, I guess it doesn't hurt for it to be uniform. What I was seeing is the charitable contribution is what necessitates or leads to the deduction, and I was seeing maybe differentiating, but it's fine if we make it uniform.
Well, I think it's better to make it uniform.
Okay, so then add deduction one.
So I had contribution here and deduction here.
Cool.
And then I also need to add deduction here and deduction here and contribution here. I think that's it, yeah.
Yeah, thus far.
Thus far.
Okay.
Deduction here. That's it. Okay,
so we are
here.
One, if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form classification N5, then the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations, B, require the donor complete IRS form 8283, C, sign off on the IRS form 8283, D, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, E, forward a copy of the appraisal and the completed form 8283 to the district designated financial officer for proper classification in the district's financial statements.
And this is the thing that Ethan said we should not do, right?
This is the placeholder person who doesn't exist. F, require the district submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1, the amount of the donation, 2, the name of the donor, 3, the circumstances of the donation, 4, any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5, a description of how the donation will be used by the district, 6, the budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue.
Okay, so real quick, let's go back to that E where we need to make a change. Perhaps forward a copy of the appraisal and the completed form 8283 to the district's general manager, and then in parentheses, we could... So let's do that first.
President of the board.
Can it be president of the board or their designee, or do you guys think that it should just be president of the board?
I think it should. Your designee can be anybody, right?
Well, I would think it would be a director.
I'm thinking so too. I'm just saying.
We probably should specify that.
Yeah.
So I'm actually, I don't remember if this is the wording we used before. Actually, I kind of want to go check because I'm not, this is not, I don't think I like this wording because this wording essentially means that if we have a general manager, but he's out of the office right now, then the president is allowed to arbitrarily sign off.
Well, let's go see what we used earlier because we might have done something similar, actually. Yeah, keep going.
In the absence of a general manager. Okay, that's a little different.
What did we have below?
Yeah, what I just did here is that in the absence of the general manager.
No, you had that.
No, if a general manager, okay.
But go back up, if you can. Okay.
It could be also I just mentally misread it just now, so it may, like, it feels like does anyone else think there's an issue here? Because now that I read it again with A, and I don't know if it feels okay, but
I'm okay with the absence.
Cool.
Is there a better word to use?
Yeah, no, absence.
Yeah, no. Once I read it again, and I really hit the A hit me, not like in the absence of the general manager.
Yeah.
It's like in the A, yeah. So.
Yeah. The president's not going behind me.
Okay, but back to the point. Do we just want to leave it the president of the board? Okay,
I think so.
See,
okay, I'm more
sense.
Comfortable.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah,
and then it could be the vice president, but then the other code it says they do what you do.
Okay,
I mean, you're not there.
Right.
So
right.
That's already accounted
for.
Cool.
We should clearly have the entire, chain of command in the sense that if Natalie isn't available, then it goes to Jonathan. Just the chair of the something else. Like.
Yeah.
Cool.
Really quickly, can you command F financial officer or whatever I had written to make sure that there's not.
There
we go.
Is more.
There are
two more. Strengths. General manager or president of the board in the absence of a.
Yeah, I don't know why the maintenance people locked that door.
Probably a mistake.
This one's open.
Financial officer. And that's in the recommendations. We'll get to that one.
Oh, yeah. That's
okay.
Okay, so now we're back where we were.
Here, if the donor is not going to claim.
If the donor is not going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form classification N6, then the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount. C, require that the district submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1, the amount of the donation, 2, the name of the donor, 3, the circumstances of the donation, 4, any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5, a description of how the donation will be used by the district, 6, the budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue, and why I said it like there was more, but there's not.
should that be rather than saying require that the district submit a letter, should it be require that the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager submit? I feel like it seems funny to say the district submit a letter to the board of directors.
That's fine. I will just point out that there are many instances in this document where I use the word district as trying to be like as broad as possible.
Okay.
So like if we correct that, then I imagine there's probably a lot of other things we're gonna have to go and correct to specify that.
Okay.
I do find it confusing though.
It does sound a little weird in that because it's like the district is being personified, they have to specifically write a letter. Rather than in other places where I wrote it, it said the district will provide. And then it's a little bit different. I guess what I'm trying to say is I think some of the weirdness of it is just because of the word, like, write. or scroll up a little bit? Is that exactly what it says? Can you scroll up a tiny bit? Oh, no, a little bit further down. Oh, no, wait, you were there.
Are we going back to the letter thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay, let's go.
Oh, so, yeah, the district submit a letter. So it doesn't even say right, it says the district submit a letter. Are you okay with that?
I don't know.
I do find it confusing.
I'm not, like, opposed, I just... It seems unclear and not providing a new direction. Require that the district
okay.
submit a letter.
Especially when it says, then the district shall require that the district submit a letter. It's like,
yeah.
The district shall require itself.
Who is this district
yeah.
and what are they doing?
Yeah.
Well, also the then, should that be a then?
Probably.
Yeah.
Wait, where?
Where is that?
Classification N6.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Oops.
This one also. This one also.
That's called copy and paste. This one also. Well, I'm comfortable with saying general manager and then same parentheses, board president in the absence of a general manager for this.
Yeah, I think we're going to need to do that.
So
should we copy and paste that now?
Okay, so what am I changing? Require that the general manager here?
Yeah, well, how we had it written in the other place, though,
okay.
was to the district's
Wait.
General manager. But I think we should just copy and paste from
You're
where
right.
we have it in other spots rather than typing it.
Okay.
And perhaps that should
be... That one doesn't say district.
The general... Well, there's other places in this document that it does say districts.
Yeah.
As written right now.
Okay, let's make sure they're all the
yeah,
same, first of
probably
all.
Probably just be as uniform as possible.
Okay. First step, they're all the same now. Second step.
Use the rest of them.
For a sec.
Is that by the way the watching program? This is Google Docs. Would you be willing to move here?
Sure. Yeah, anytime.
Thank you. You're just looking at the computer screen a little bit more square enough.
Good enough?
Yeah, that's great. It's just, and then Ethan will
oh,
just
yeah.
come forward a second.
In the way
the camera,
of
yeah,
yeah that's why I had you move to there.
Yeah. Okay, I didn't know we were camera-wise, whatever. Being on film doesn't bother me at all. So.
Well, you know, it's not that it would bother
Jay
you, it's that your head is just in the center of the frame because of the...
Oh, yeah, I didn't know it was behind us. Okay,
I'm
sorry.
Yeah.
I
did
know
the same thing. I did the same
thing. I thought the camera was there. Okay. My mistake. Oh, well. Interesting. I did not have a chance to go over YouTube tutorials concerns with breezing up on the formats of operating components as well as the English lingua. So anyway, a lot of research for joint advertising. I dug into a couple of days ago. Nothing really good. We're just going back over more in detail. And on top of that,
now that Ethan's back, actually, I think we should probably
yeah.
go on with the meeting.
Sure.
Yeah.
Emotional intelligence.
So we were on. We just finished changing all the instances of submit a district submit a letter.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And
so
now it's district general manager or
Great. Is this your general manager or president or in absence of the general manager?
That's not the one though. Here, it's this one. Require the district general manager or president submit a letter.
Yeah, you're right. And then the things that the letter includes are delineated. And if we continue down, we can go to 2. If the donor is not going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form classification N6, then the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, C, require the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of the A.
We want to remove that. I got it.
Well, no, but I probably copy and paste this in a million places. Let's check it.
Yeah. Just search the A.
Since of
just search
the A.
The A.
Yes.
Yes.
Bye.
Okay.
Does Google Docs have a find and replace function? This is off topic.
Yes.
It does. Cool. Okay.
You have to click the 3 dots.
Okay. Let's see.
I think we actually had already read this, by the way.
Yeah,
so now we're on 9.
If the donation is a non-cash donation of $10,000 or greater and is received from a 501c3, the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, C, require the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager, submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes all the other things that we have previously listed, name of the donor, circumstances, any and all caveats and obligations that acceptance may require, a description of how the donation will be used by the district, budget revision, and that's about it. That's now at the end of the policy. So
okay.
These are...
Yeah, we can, this?
We can strike that, yeah.
Okay.
No more financial officer. That's
one
not
fewer
a real,
officer.
Not a real person. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, I think this is good. If anyone wants to pull up any other donation policies and see if there's anything that we should be including in here that wasn't included in this, just to be as extensive as possible. Feel free.
This is separate, maybe related to donations, but was discussed at the board meeting. And our district has a gifts policy, which is donations, and then a grants policy. So we have like a separate thing for grants, and
mm-hmm.
if we get them from like a San Remo Foundation or
yeah.
whatever.
Maybe that would be the next.
Another thing to work on that today.
All these districts, I think they just steal the formatting from CSDA. Doesn't that look familiar to you, Ethan? Hold on, he'll go back in a moment.
We should try to find the CSD that's like the most developed and best in the state and just see what they do.
Just hang out with them?
Yeah.
Yes, that's exactly the format.
Yeah.
I mean, in a number of years, I think any involved directors will be very qualified to be giving advice to organizations like CSDA.
Yeah.
Okay, so there is, I just talked about my public contributions. Donations from members of the public to the district for a public purpose that is within the scope of the district's responsibilities will be accepted.
Gotta make sure.
They will.
They will be accepted. The finance division manager will provide a receipt for said donation and include the district's tax identification number therein. Donations must be clearly marked as such. Deposits by a property owner with a service account will be assumed to be a payment towards their account's unpaid balance, or payment in advance of billing in the event the account does not have an unpaid balance. If the deposit is not clearly marked as being a donation for a specific public purpose. By accepting donations, the district is not claiming to be qualified by the Internal Revenue Service as being a charitable organization for which donations may be considered tax deductible. The determination of how donations to the district are to be treated relative to the donor's tax liability is strictly the responsibility of the donor.
So that's when they do the 82, 83, right?
82, yeah. District's response is to simply be like, it's your problem.
Wait, but that's weird because they have to sign the 82-83 if they want to take it. And when you sign the 82-83, you're specifically saying
it's your problem.
We are you're saying we certify that we are a tax deductible agency.
In practice, that might just mean though that it is not legally possible to donate something more than $5,000 to this organization.
But then also, I'm sure the authors of this know that. No matter what they have in policy here, they still have to follow the IRS code.
That's just super weird.
I think
weird.
It's saying, like, by us having this policy doesn't mean we're not claiming to be qualified, but if you wanted us to sign off, let's sign off. I don't know.
But when you sign off, you're specifically, if you want to go back to the form, I'm pretty sure that when you sign off, you're specifically saying, I affirm that I, as a representative of this organization, I'm affirming this organization is something that could be used for tax deductible contributions.
But you only have to sign that form if it's more than $5,000 or something.
Yes, so which is why I'm agreeing with what you said about how in practice that policy might prevent them from accepting donations over $5,000.
Cool. But back to what we just worked on.
Yes.
What
I don't see anything in here that we don't already have. Frankly, ours is better. Sorry, Indian Valley.
Okay. Go, Bob.
Do we have a title at the top of this policy?
We have a county level donation policy.
Donation policy.
Original
grant. This is what you went to other reference here, cross reference to what he mentioned about accepting grants.
Grant policy would be completely separate from this, and. Maybe that's what the committee wants to tackle next. We can get into that under the next item.
Yeah. All right, so I think that we'll be there very soon.
Yeah.
So donation policy, I imagine that doesn't fit the kinds of top titles that we have otherwise because I think it's...
No.
Yeah, so...
That was...
donations.
So I think
shareable
to fit the others, it would be like that, right? That's how we had other ones, correct?
We have things like... Rules of order for board meetings. We have things like purpose board policies.
My point was Ethan's just adding policy title colon. But I think Spencer and I were both talking about like the way in which the title part is like donation policy has the word policy.
Mm-hmm.
But like you don't. Yeah.
Oh, it should actually.
It should.
Well, we don't have it's not called conflict of interest policy.
Well, what we
the policy
have...
is titled conflict of interest.
Oh, wait, you're right, because what I was looking at is I just saw policies at the end of adoption/amendment of policies.
Oh.
And the policies is necessary for that to be a thing.
Yeah. Imagine adoption of policy/amendment of policies. redundant. I think donations is adequate. It seems simple, but... Let's not spend too much time worrying.
Should
about
it be them. Receiving and accepting?
Receiving and accepting?
Or maybe just accepting donations?
Yeah. That is what we're doing with this policy. Yeah. Accepting donations.
Processing and accepting?
Accepting is fine.
Accepting.
Let's not get too fancy.
Now, in making this, do we need to read the whole thing out, or?
I don't know. I can read really fast.
I mean, I have no problem
with
us reading it. All right, I have a motion.
Okay.
All right, Ethan's
going
to do it.
If you want.
Ethan's going to do it.
And you're going to help me with... moving the big screen, right?
Yeah, but
maybe zoom out a tiny bit.
Also,
I want to, oh, I see, I have to click here. And then, oh, it is this, yeah. And then, that's going to be horrible. I guess I can figure it out later.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out later.
Great.
We just, as long
because,
as we read it
yeah,
out.
Yeah, here's the other thing is that I think when you do that, you strip it of the formatting.
I know, that was what happened.
Yeah.
I hit the key that leaves the formatting in as
yeah.
opposed to the one that strips it, but,
and it's
you know,
the,
whatever.
Yeah. Oh, well. Thanks, Apple.
Yeah, so what we were doing before, not in this one, here.
Ethan, thank you in advance for
no,
your service
there.
To
this
committee for reading this on the off.
Okay. Oh.
You maybe zoom out there. A tiny bit. Yeah, there you go.
What is this explore button? I'm just going to click it and then make it go away. Yeah, that's better. Okay.
All right. I move to recommend that the Board of Directors adopt the following policy titled Accepting Donations. Under Internal Revenue Service Code, Section 170C1, and California Government Code, Section 6116A.
1116.
Correction, 6116A, to be noted in this motion. The district may accept donations as charitable contributions. Individuals, companies, or organizations may wish to donate money, items, or services to the district as a public service. Donations include cash or any item, physical or digital, such as equipment, books, digital photos, etc., or service, such as staff time, donated for utilization by the district. The district recognizes the value of donations from individuals and organizations and affirms that they provide a unique opportunity for community involvement to enhance the district and the community. Acceptance of a donation requires that the accounting and internal revenue service statutes and regulations as described in later sections be followed by the district. A donation of any amount may be presented to the Board of Directors for acceptance or rejection if the board determines that doing so would serve the public interest. Donations. 1. A donation is defined as a voluntary transfer of money or tangible item without compensation to a charity or public institution. A transfer that stipulates advertising, marketing, or other quid pro quo in return for the transfer is not a donation and is beyond the scope of this policy. 2. Donations are not to be accepted from individuals or agencies where acceptance will require the donor to receive a substantial benefit from the district or will allow the donor to determine policy or to exert influence on the district. 3. Donations may be accepted directly from taxpayers, such as individuals, partnerships, and corporations, or from 501c3 nonprofit entities. 4. The two categories of donations that the district may accept are cash and non-cash in-kind donations. Non-cash donations can include goods, supplies, equipment, vehicles, buildings, land, computer software, works of art, historical treasures, and other. Non-cash donations should have value to the district in its form for acceptance. Within each of these two categories exist different donation classifications. 5. Multiple individual donations from the same donor, each with a value of less than $10,000, upon totaling $10,000 or greater during a calendar year, would meet the $10,000 threshold requiring Board of Directors acceptance. A pledge of $10,000 or greater that will be paid in installments would also require Board of Directors acceptance. 6. Donations shall be officially accepted by the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager of the district or the Board of Directors prior to placing the donation in use. The district may have physical possession of the donation prior to official acceptance, but must return the donation if it is not accepted. 7.
District directors or staff must avoid any actual or perceived conflict of interest surrounding donations. All donations must be made and any actions taken by district officials or employees must be with complete impartiality and without favoritism, and the appearance of partiality or favoritism must be avoided. For example, the district must not solicit donations from organizations over which they may have regulatory or enforcement authority. The district is required to only pursue donations consistent with a public purpose that is within the scope of the district's responsibilities, strategic plans, and policy. 8. If a donor estimates that a non-cash donation has a value of $5,000 or more, an appraisal is necessary if that donation is other than supplies or materials. The appraisal cost cannot be added to the estimated value of the item. Additionally, the cost and the pursuit of the appraisal should be the responsibility of the donor. The reference to qualified appraisals in this document is in accordance with IRS Publication 561, available at www.irs.gov. Supplies and materials that are new and have never been placed in service prior to the donation may be valued with purchase receipts provided by the donor as long as the elapsed time of transfer would not have affected the value. 9. The following items are excluded from the acceptance or rejection requirements of the proposed policy. A. Volunteer service hours. These are not considered donations since these services are not allowable as IRS charitable deductions, and their value is not reported on district financial records. However, the district will periodically acknowledge volunteer service hours as a matter of public interest. B. Shared cost programs. Programs that share the cost of a district project with individuals or agencies, resulting in a benefit for both the district and the cost sharer. These are not considered donations since the individual or other agency is receiving something from the district in return for their contribution. C. Operating or capital grants. Procedures. 1. All donations must be made in compliance with California Government Code Section 81000, Internal Revenue Service Code Section 170C1, and California Government Code Section 61116. Strike that last proposed. 2. If the donation is appropriate, a completed receipt must be given to the donor, indicating the estimated value of the donation, date, name of the donor, donor type, donor address, purpose of donation, donation classification as defined below, and type of donation. 3. If the donation is a cash donation of less than $10,000, classification C1, the district shall A. provide a receipt to the donor, B. deposit the money into the district treasury in a timely manner, C. complete a budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue. 4. If the donation is a cash donation of $10,000 or more, classification C2, the district shall A. provide a receipt to the donor, B. deposit the money into the district treasury in a timely manner, C. complete a budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue, D. require that the district's general manager or president of the board, in the absence of a general manager, submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation. That includes 1. The amount of the donation, 2. The name of the donor, 3. The circumstances of the donation, 4. Any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5. A description of how the donation will be used by the districts, 6. The budget revision if necessary to appropriate the donation revenue. E. Action by the board will result in the recording of acceptance or rejection in the Board of Directors' minutes. Rejection will result in the donation being returned to its rightful owner. 5. If the donation is a non-cash donation of less than $5,000, classification N1, the district shall A. provide a receipt to the donor that includes the value of the donation as agreed upon by the district and the donor to be less than $5,000. 6. If the donation is a non-cash donation of $5,000 or greater and less than $10,000 and is received from a taxpayer, the district shall A. determine if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form. 1. If the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form, classification N2, then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations, B. require the donor complete IRS form 8283, C. sign off on the IRS form 8283, D. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, E. forward a copy of the appraisal and the completed form 8283 to the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager for proper classification in the district's financial statements. 2. If the donor is not going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form, classification M3, then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount. 7. If the donation is a non-cash donation of $5,000 or greater and less than $10,000 and is received from a 501c3 classification N4, the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount. 8. If the donation is a non-cash donation of $10,000 or greater and is received from a taxpayer, the district shall A. determine if the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form. 1. If the donor is going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form, classification N5, then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations, B. require the donor complete IRS form 8283, C. sign off on the IRS form 8283, D. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, E. forward a copy of the appraisal and the completed form 8283 to the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager for proper classification in the district's financial statements. F. require that the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager submit a letter to the Board of Directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1. The amount of the donation, 2. The name of the donor, 3. The circumstances of the donation, 4. Any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5. A description of how the donation will be used by the district, 6. The budget revision, if necessary, to appropriate the donation revenue. 2. If the donor is not going to claim the donation as a charitable contribution deduction on their tax form, classification N6, then the district shall A. require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B. provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, C. require that the district's general manager or president of the board in the absence of a general manager submit a letter to the Board of Directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1. The amount of the donation, 2, the name of the donor. 3, the circumstances of the donation. 4, any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require. 5, a description of how the donation will be used by the district. 6, the budget revision, if necessary, to appropriate the donation revenue. 9, if the donation is a non-cash donation of $10,000 or greater and is received from a 501c3, the district shall A, require a qualified appraisal per IRS regulations for items other than materials and supplies, B, provide a receipt to the donor for the valued amount, C, require that the district's general manager or president of the board, in the absence of a general manager, submit a letter to the board of directors for approval or rejection of the donation that includes 1, the amount of the donation, 2, the name of the donor, 3, the circumstances of the donation, 4, any and all caveats or obligations that acceptance may require, 5, a description of how the donation will be used by the district, 6, the budget revision, if necessary, to appropriate the donation revenue.
You are the best.
That was amazing.
Is someone going to second?
I second.
Thank you. I would leave it.
Almost forgot that I had
to. Motion dies. That's
I have a couple amendments that I want to ask if they're friendly with you first.
Yes.
So in at the top, in donations, section 5, I wanted to change the phrase calendar year to fiscal year, that this is for the time frame of which we're talking about donations totaling $10,000 or more.
But this is going off of someone's tax contribution deduction. That's per a calendar year, not the fiscal year of the district, right? Does that matter?
No.
Maybe not.
I don't think it matters.
Okay.
Because that's for whether we accept it or not, not how we process it.
Great. Okay. Friendly with the first. Can we make that change right away?
So what am I changing something?
Section 5 under donations is at the very top.
I'm like there right now. I have it.
You got it.
Well, bring it up and I have it highlighted.
You do?
Yes.
Wait, what?
Number 5, donations.
That's number 5.
Weird.
Okay.
Right there. Okay.
All right.
So, okay, friendly with the maker, amended.
The other is in section 7, capitalize district as it appears in, where was it? No, you were right there.
I'm sorry, I think you're looking at your computer. I forgot that you were getting here. Yeah.
Typographical error, huh?
Oh, district right there as it appears in the third sentence. For example, the district.
Got it.
Is that friendly?
Yeah, cool.
Friendly, amended.
Reinstate all instances of the phrase at SEC.
Yeah.
Friendly.
All right.
What is SEC abbreviated for?
Section?
No.
I think it's something else. I forget what it is.
And what follows? Et seq.
Oh.
Et seq.
Et sequentis. Ex sequentis.
Okay.
And also, you did not. You said equipments.
Can we strike the plural?
Friendly.
Okay. And with that.
But I need you to be. We need to, for the amendment, be more specific about et seq, because in the motion, it's assuming I didn't have a script.
There were exactly 2 modifications. You left out this one, and you left out this one.
Can we?
I amend my motion to include, or to add, et seq, period, following the mention of government code section 81000 and government code section 61116.
Friendly with the second. Those were all the amendments I had. Do you have any, Jake?
No, that was it.
The only thing that I had in mind was I noticed that at the beginning of this document we were using will in places that later in the document we were using would.
Can you give an example?
Sure. Number two under donations. Donations are not to be accepted from individuals or agencies where acceptance will require the donor to receive a substantial benefit from the district or will allow the donor. My point is that later on in the document, if I'm thinking correctly, we say would meet the $10,000 threshold.
So are we, also thinking, we change instances of will to would?
Perhaps.
Because who's to determine what will, quote unquote, allow the donor to determine policy? I think.
Well, do we have a grammatical issue or no?
I mean, it sounds like you thought we did.
I did, but are you saying we don't? Or?
No. I'm saying we should change instances of will to would.
Okay.
Are you in agreement?
On a case-by-case basis, let's start.
Case by case.
Yeah.
The structure is right down with a slash marks and proposals. Would require the donor to
receive substantial. Jay, what do you think about splitting the world?
Will require the donor to receive donations or not to be accepted from individuals or agencies who accept it. Would require the donor to receive acceptance or will. Would. Wow.
I am fascinated by this one. This is awesome. I'm certainly okay if you change it to would.
Got your eyes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is it friendly with the first if we amend that
so
to say
friendly.
Would?
So friendly.
That instance, both instances of the word will in section two of donations.
Friendly.
Do you see any other instances where we may need to
yep. Please scroll down and
look
see
over
what I have highlighted.
Yeah. Two woods.
It has different connotations to change the second one to would, I think.
Donations are not to be accepted from individuals or agencies where acceptance would require the donor to receive a substantial benefit from the district or would allow the donor to determine policy or to exert influence on the district. I'm not seeing it.
I'm not either.
Well, I think it's better almost, but it does feel different to me.
I mean, would
yeah,
is will in the past tense. They are the same word.
I will not go to the store. I would not go to the store. Very different. And so it depends on like the. There's some subtlety there of like the sentence where in like some cases they feel almost the same and in some cases they're just not.
They're past tense. It's like the same word in the past tense. But yeah.
Well, I don't think this is past tense.
Yeah. Well. It's,
yeah.
But
speaking in the past tense carries a certain connotation, is what he's saying.
Yeah, in the case that you will go to the store, then you should buy me some eggs while you're there. In the case that you would go to the store, you should go to the store and buy me some eggs while you're there. Like would is an intent, whereas will is an act. And that's why it's interesting.
I just have to say, the policy committee... I love that we get into the weeds. We are so far down into the soil.
So you
want to
keep going. I'm okay with you changing those two. So
yeah.
Okay.
Keep changing some stuff.
Number five.
Okay.
I have it. I have that highlighted. It's not showing on yours, but I'm amending that to would.
Yeah.
A pledge of
$10,000
or greater that would be paid in installments would also require a board of directors acceptance.
How about just or greater to be paid in installments?
Say that again.
Friendly.
Changing
these two words with the word to.
Be paid in installments.
Cool.
Did you make the edit?
Are you changing
it's not,
it?
It's like not showing
I'm confused,
up.
So
I didn't.
Wondering.
I was
okay.
Trying to find
okay.
The place. It was oh, you got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Any others?
Number nine, However, the district...
That's the correct usage of the word will.
Okay. Number four under procedures.
I like will a lot.
That's also
here.
The correct usage of the word will.
Would fit though too. We could
but
say that the first.
I mean,
word.
would fit.
Oh no! Stop.
How the donation would be used for the district sounds awkwardly passive to me.
Yeah.
Will be used for the district sounds more actionable.
Okay.
I'm reading in English. Thing says you could use would to talk about hypotheses or like hypothetical situations. So. Makes sense.
So would could fit there, you're saying?
Yeah, because it's hypothetical.
Right. Which
would could fit there. But
it wasn't as good as your first one.
Will it?
Like it would be expensive to stay at the hotel.
I favor will.
We could also put the word could here. Like if we want to get really hypothetical.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
just like show me all the ways the donation
yeah.
could be used
yeah.
by
this
the district.
This will, it could be a will. Sorry, I was talking about the prior.
A description of how the donation will be used by the district.
Yeah, because it's the future.
Mm-hmm.
Future tense.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I think you guys
so
have different. So, like, you're saying it doesn't fit, right?
No, I think a description of how the donation will be used is a good. You could use will. You
okay.
could also use would because it's hypothetical, but
yeah.
you could use will as a future tense. It says, but I'm reading this thing.
Okay.
It does say it's a conditional.
Cool.
The conditionals, I think, what we're trying to preserve.
We could also use could. Like, we could get really.
No, but could is too. No, could is very non-committal.
Yeah.
I know. I think would is already non-committal.
I mean, we could use could.
I, that's
but,
why, that's
okay,
why I liked will.
E,
yeah.
E, action by the board, will. Result, will or would?
Will.
Will.
Okay.
Will, yeah.
What about that rejection, will? Yeah.
Yeah, continue. I think that from here on out, I think the instances of will are probably going to win out.
Okay.
So by the way, so in the world of modal auxiliaries, some people, many of the standards bodies that I end up dealing with, essentially only want you to use either must or should or
shall?
Possibly must or shall. And so in order to avoid some of this problem, because it's like you can put must in almost all the cases where we really like would, action by the board must result in the recording of acceptance or rejection by the board of directors minutes. But yeah, will is a funny one.
Okay. So
high score, I think you won. I think you won the good.
Yeah. And then see here we have
apple.
A shall.
By the way, you all get apple
yeah.
by the way.
I think yeah, as long as there's nothing that is actually going to be.
Oh yeah, no, it's not shall because shall still has yeah, it's or should. Because there are some cases where it's essentially we're being wishy washy about things and you're allowed to just say should. But that way you avoid being wishy washy with a term that people don't know is wishy washy.
Ethan, do you see anything else?
Nope, I have the motion.
All right.
Second, there's been amendments.
Cool. So, are we done?
I'm ready to vote.
Okay. Any public comment?
No.
Okay, Jonathan,
you were
any more?
Relevant, you said must or you said should.
All right.
Very direct when you say that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, motion passes 3-0. I've made a copy of this wording so that I have, in case no one can change it now. All right.
Cool. All right, so we did that.
We did something. All right. No, here. No, that's not it. No, I did something dumb.
Yeah, let's get that one.
What am I doing wrong?
Because I think we're all in agreement
one.
About
Got
that
it.
One.
Okay.
Can you scroll up a little bit?
In my notes?
Oh, no. Well, there was something that we had deferred to this point.
If we're moving on to item
the
four,
agenda,
are we?
You want the agenda?
Oh, no. No, I'm talking about on your
action.
Notes that you had. Yeah, are
which
we moving on
right
to item
above
four?
What you just typed right there.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think we're moving on to item four now,
okay.
but if there's something
okay.
I'm wrong.
No, you're good. No, I was
okay.
anticipating that you were going to do that, and I would
okay,
like
cool.
to make the motion of the text that we had sitting there.
The text that we had sitting there. Oh, that's right. I understand what you're talking about now.
I have a motion. I move to recommend that the board of directors amend section one of the policy titled.
No, it's 5.1. Five point one.
Yeah, I just copied and pasted it.
Of
the policy
rules
titled
of order for board meetings.
All right, I rescind my motion. I move to recommend that the board of directors amend section 5.1 of the policy titled Rules of Order for Board Meetings to read, the president may eject any person or persons making impertinent or slanderous remarks or statements that are not germane to items under the subject jurisdiction of the district, refusing to abide by a request from the president, or otherwise disrupting the meeting or hearing.
Second. But my question is, didn't we put in not germane to take out impertinent? Or
that's what I was just thinking
there.
Right now.
Yeah. I would like for to see if we can amend it to take that out.
Friendly.
That being
impertinent.
Okay.
Public comment? Jonathan? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. What is everyone doing? All in favor? Aye.
You voted already.
Yeah.
Good, but I voted twice. What happens now? I screwed up. I wasn't paying attention.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't vote twice. Stop. You just thought you did. You did all those in favor.
Yeah.
We all voted together.
Right.
3-0 motion passes, right?
Yeah, 3-0
yeah.
Motion passes. I was just like, all in favor? Then, of course, we all say nay. Like, that's not how this works, Jade.
Cool.
Okay.
All right.
Is there anything else that we'd like to consider under item 4?
I'd like us to consider moving to item 5.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
I just want to say like one thing that we don't have to do anything about it or anything. I just want to, so because I think we can do this under this because it's fairly broadly agendized in terms of the stuff that we can do. My impression was at the last meeting was that we decided that we were going to try to get more background out of directors by forcing the process to actually have it so that it would be like there would be a letter, for example. That's why I sent that letter and actually agonized over sending the letters. I was like, well, okay, I'm gonna send this letter because I'm gonna provide all this background and everything. And so I was surprised when I got the memo about the preferred board member practices saying don't send a letter. And because then it's I'm not certain how to, like, then I feel like I want to go back and actually have a policy to force background, because I want the director who had the board, the item to put on the thing, I want them to actually come and explain in detail why they added it to the to the agenda. And if they're not going to provide a letter with it, and what the cool thing about the letter is that that's what, like, the board of supervisors always gets those letters from the department that provided the agenda item that has the background and the fiscal analysis, and that was actually the demo that I had at the time of, like, I want something to get this much information out of people. And so I appreciate it if the idea is that we just legally can't do it that way, but then I want some other way of doing it.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing that I will say is that, well, first of all, that's not quite the understanding that I thought
that
we'd come
to,
which
is
why
I understand, not your understanding. Yeah, I understand. Yeah.
So the first thing is that when the Board of Supervisors includes the staff report, it is a staff report. It is done by staff.
Mm-hmm.
The staff falls under the direction of the Board of Supervisors, and they serve at their pleasure. As a director who places an item on the agenda, you are not in that kind of staff role, and I don't think it is quite appropriate for directors to be providing fiscal analysis for things that are coming before consideration for the board of directors, because the effect that it has is representing that the district's objective analysis of how this is going to affect us is this, even if it is just the thoughts and opinions of one director. I, like, 100%, I agree with you so much that, like, we can't just be, like, taking items of consideration without giving background on them. That background, I really think it needs to be verbal. I think that we need to, that needs to be something that is had in deliberation. I don't think that there, at this time, I don't see a way for us to institutionalize or to get that down in writing in any way. I think one of the things that I've seen actually that has been happening was the way that Ethan presented things on the internship, which was that he had a presentation. Hopefully in the future we will have some sort of mechanism vis-a-vis the interns so that those who have assigned interns can do the presentation, and then the director who created it can kind of just sit back and watch and critique from afar their own work. But I'm really concerned about having board letters attached to each item that could be misrepresented as the opinion of the board of directors.
But isn't that the benefit of having the letter from an individual? Because that way it's very clear that this letter is addressed to the board. It is from an individual board member.
Well, yeah, I think we have to make that more clear. I think we have to make that more clear, but I don't think that we can say no more to the board letters. Even though I'm really upset with previous perception of letters that have been submitted that weren't reflective of the whole board but may have been taken that way, I still think it's really important that we have that opportunity to submit letters, because especially if it's a fiscal analysis, we just can't get around that. And I don't think that board members saying it orally will satisfy the questions of other directors. So I do think it's important that we come up with a policy that allows for letters to be submitted from individual directors, but specifies a protocol in which it can be very easily understood by everyone that this just reflects the opinion of a director.
Because I guess another aspect of that is from the perspective of like fiscal analysis, things like that, when I look at the Board of Supervisors' agenda, I don't use the agenda. I use the board letters. Like, the agenda for me is just a summary of keywords that I use in order to see, oh, are they mentioning something that I'm vaguely interested in? Yes. And then I read the board letter. Because the board letter tells me whether or not I actually care to go to the meeting. It tells me what the item is about and why. And so I don't feel like the agenda item is, like, it's not about how to communicate with the board members from the perspective of having the letter associated, the background and all the analysis and everything. It's to make certain that 72 hours before the discussion, the public has the background and has the analysis that had gone into why it was there in the first place. And maybe it's flawed fiscal analysis because it was done by a director who didn't really know everything that needed to be known, but I mean, the staff also can make a mistake. But it was that flawed analysis that caused the director to want to put the item on the agenda, which then is what's going to cause people to want to show up in order to discuss the thing. Mm-hmm. So
is it your impression that it's standard for small special districts of our size to have the sort of board letter structure? Because, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, IVRB doesn't do this, do they?
Well, the general manager submits a detailed report on what we're considering. And right now we don't have that. And in that absence, I think board members need to submit detailed reports.
Are they available to the public? I personally...
If they're not available to the public before the meeting, they're made available preceding the meeting.
Okay. So, one thing really quickly is that I didn't mean for in my memo to say don't submit letters. What I was saying was don't editorialize in the agenda description.
Well, no, actually, I'm not even... I've got your thing up here. I'm trying to... Don't use the item description as a way to write your own staff report that includes your version of the background, context, fiscal analysis, or otherwise of the item you're requesting be placed on the agenda. And specifically what I had wanted out of the letter was a way to provide a staff report that included a background, context, fiscal analysis, and otherwise of the item you placed on the agenda.
So, but don't use the
maybe
item.
Maybe we can't
item
do that. Like, I
item description, though. So item description being
okay, well,
this
okay,
stuff
here we go. Yes, okay. But then we are allowed to
that's
provide
what,
that.
What I was concerned about, and because I think that's when we get into the territory where the opinions and thoughts of directors are being misrepresented as board materials, board documents.
Okay, so then
But a letter attached can do that.
Yes, okay. I'm not telling you not to attach letters at all. I don't think that's what the memo was telling you either.
I got it.
I'm sorry if you thought otherwise.
Yeah. I'm by the way, incredibly sorry that I have not fleshed this out so accurately or anything.
It's fine. It's just that this memo was specifically for placing items that go on the agenda. And the reasoning for me to want to send this was so that when a director submits an item for me to put on the agenda as the secretary, I don't have to go in and make tweaks to it to get it to a place where it's presentable. I would like for board members to be able to send me items that are just presentable and I don't have to go in and tweak them, because I think we're in a really legally gray area when I start doing that.
Because I had taken this as simply an outright, this is all you should do, nothing in addition to this. Okay.
So.
Okay. Cool. Anything else in that we want to do tonight in agenda item 4?
Not from me.
Members of the public.
None 4 now.
Okay. Then number 5, future meeting dates, including setting a new regular meeting date, because our old regular meeting date got stomped on by that other thing that occurred earlier today.
I'm not entirely sure what that other thing is.
I found out actually by accident when I got the key, because they had two keys. Wait, because Roddy wasn't here today, and so he had two keys waiting with little stickers on them, and she read the first sticker off, but I don't remember what it was anymore. It was like family something. Some sort of kind of.
Okay.
But
well, all the power to them. They got it before we did. I personally think that 7 o'clock is fine. My Mondays at 7 are good.
So I only did 7 today, as opposed to I think it was you recommended 6:30 at the.
I did.
Yeah, I only did 7 because that would give people more time to spend at the Measure O thing, which was from 5 to 7.
Yeah.
I figured people were originally was scheduled to 5 to 7.
Yeah, so. Well, I don't have a problem with that. I mean, it seems better to me that we start on the dot rather than a half hour. But
all right, I'm totally okay with 7.
I think 6:30 is better, just because we all work all day. And getting here a half hour early can make all the difference with us being tired at the end of the meeting and having to end without doing as much.
Cool. I work all night, which is why it doesn't occur to me.
Okay.
Yeah, so,
good
yeah.
point.
Yeah,
so we should keep that into consideration.
Well, no, but it doesn't matter for me. So, yeah. So 6:30 is great for me.
I move that we set a regular meeting date for the 2nd and 4th Mondays of each month at 6:30 p.m. to occur in 970 Embarcadero Del Mar, the community room.
This here.
Yes, this right here.
2nd.
Did you say in the community room or the community room?
I think you said.
Oh, I just said 970 Embarcadero Del Mar,
the
comma,
community room.
The
comma.
Community room.
Okay, comma, right. Okay. That was. Oh, you said you seconded. I heard
mm-hmm.
right. Yeah. Okay. Public comment. All in favor?
Aye.
All in favor? Wait.
No, you did it. Stop.
This time I said all in favor 2 times. I said all in favor. You all said
okay,
aye.
All
opposed. I said all opposed.
All right. Hearing
none.
We're good.
Motion passes 3-0. There we go. All right.
Sweet.
Okay.
Awesome. That's
this time I said all in favor 2 times in a row. That was the mistake.
Yeah, I was not expecting that. So I'm just going to say that, like, going forward in this committee, I found it very, like, personally helpful for me to just go. And even though I was, like, largely copying, or not copying and pasting, but, like, rewriting stuff that was on Bob's, like, recommended stuff,
mm-hmm.
I'm probably going to continue to do that just because it's helpful for me. It gives me a better understanding than just reading it does. So with whatever we decide to do, I'll be happy to bring back some compilation/recommendations.
I again will apologize profusely for not putting our previous future meeting agenda item of review the policy manual compilation on this agenda.
Can we put it on the next one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Let's see. And I think there was all, was there also something about communications that didn't quite make it on?
Yeah, and you wanted to add, which I thought we could, I wasn't certain if we, it was a mistake that I did not make the change. Either the change of the board to of the district or adding communications and technology, but
yeah.
We are so broadly agendized to number four that I don't, if you want
yeah,
to talk
about
it.
Yeah, I think you're right. I'll just write it down.
So let's continue to have number four in its standard version. We can take out the request from Natalie that we flesh out more structure.
Oh, so we're not, will I put in still communication technology then?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. But remove. What is request here?
Would a policy on, well, I guess I answered my own question, a policy on external representation would originate in this committee?
Not all policies.
External
like
representation, that's something we tackle?
That's fine.
All right, I'd like an item regarding external representation.
Okay. And so this is, because I'm going to have to put some kind of description associated with it.
Representing the district
at meetings?
At external events, meetings. Sweet. I can't think of anything else. And I'm fried.
Okay.
You got
if we think of other things, we can email you only about adding, right?
Yes.
Great.
Okay, and moving on to item six, adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Any public comment?
Okay. You're right. Any public comment?
No, that's quite right.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Meeting adjourned at 10:41 p.m.